conference champion. So Jackie Sherrill returns home to seek yet another title. And as the years passed, the Cotton Bowl has seemed like home to another team from another region. The Fighting Irish of Notre Dame appeared here four times during the 70s. And their return today marks a homecoming to the place where so much of their rich tradition is tied. It's been a showcase for great players. From the scrambling of Joe Theismann to the comeback theatrics of Joe Montana. Today, 9 years since Notre Dame's last appearance, the Cotton Bowl is host to college football's best player. This is a homecoming for Heisman Trophy winner Tim Brown, who, like fellow Heisman winner Davey O'Brien 50 years ago, attended Woodrow Wilson High in Dallas. And today, Tim Brown is back to fulfill a lifelong dream.
I've won the Heisman Trophy, and I'm playing my last collegiate game for one of the greatest universities, and I'm home. I've tried not to get excited, but today I'm hoping to explode.
Happy New Year, everybody. I'm Brent Musburger. My pleasure today to be working alongside Pat Hayden. John Dockery will be down on the sideline. And then at halftime, the coach, Ara Parseghan, will be along with Jim Nance. We think we've got a dandy for you here today. The Aggies of Texas A&M come into the Cotton Bowl for the third straight year. 2 years ago, they defeated Auburn. And last New Year's Day, they were beaten by Ohio State. One of the major themes is the return to prominence of the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame under the coaching leadership of Lou Holtz. This is their first major bowl since they played in the Sugar in 1981. But let's turn back the calendar a few months and show you exactly how the Aggies and the Fighting Irish got to this Cotton Bowl. Texas A&M began the season with high hopes. But when Reveille sounded, most of the barking was over the play of the defense. It was this unit that held the Aggies together early. Coach Jackie Sherrill is always talking chemistry, but he also needed some offense. They went 2-2 in their first four games. Enter two freshmen, a quarterback, Bucky Richardson, and a running back, Darren Lewis. And their impact was immediate. The Aggies rolled through the next six games. And then it was time to play for the trip to the Cotton Bowl against Texas. Late in the fourth quarter, Richardson came on in relief. It was the winning touchdown. And Jackie Sherrill had earned a third straight Southwest Conference title and a third consecutive trip to the Cotton Bowl in Dallas. At Notre Dame, the season began with all eyes on the Heisman Trophy favorite, Tim Brown. He gave Lou Holtz hope for a return to prominence for the Fighting Irish. Against Michigan State, Brown exploded. He returned two punts for touchdowns. And he became the early odds-on favorite to win the Heisman. The Irish stayed unbeaten until they ran into a tough Pitt Panther team. The Panthers knocked out starting quarterback Terry Andrzak, and the option quarterback, youngster Tony Rice, came on. But it was the offensive line that became the new stars. They blocked and led the way as Notre Dame shot down USC in Alabama and still had a chance at the national championship until Joe Paterno in Penn State stopped a last-second two-point conversion on November 21st. A week later, the dejected Fighting Irish were thrashed by the Miami Hurricanes, and they come into this Cotton Bowl with an 8-3 record. Happy New Year, Pat, and Notre Dame also comes in here with a new quarterback again.
Well, it's remarkable to me. Here we are on January 1st, the 12th game of the year, and the quarterback situation for both teams is really still up in the air. Notre Dame will start senior Terry Andrzak. He started early in the year, of course, injured, but did not play a play in the last seven games. Now, And they're hoping he's going to add more balance to their team. A&M will start a freshman, Bucky Richardson. He's an option quarterback, a strong player. They've played with three quarterbacks and one with three. I wouldn't be surprised to see more than one today.
Wouldn't be a Lou Holtz show without a little surprise. Let's go down to our colleague, John Dockery. Doc?
Thank you, Brent. We talk so much about Notre Dame tradition. Well, when the team comes out of this locker room moments from now, they'll be departing from a recent tradition because they'll be wearing names on the back of their jerseys, and that's not Lou Holtz tradition. The way it happened was this. The players talked him into it, and they said, look, if we go to a bowl, especially the Cotton Bowl, will you allow us to have jerseys with our names on them and keep them after the game? Lou said, fine. But, Brent, don't expect to see it next year because with Lou Holtz, it's very simple. It's team first, an individual second. But at least it makes it easier for the announcers today. Now back to you.
Exactly right, John. And the crowd has been coming into the Cotton Bowl for the last hour and a half to 2 hours. And if the quarterbacks aren't All-Americans, Pat, I guess this game may feature the running backs.
Well, in two different styles, really. A&M will come out and run the option play early in the game. Notre Dame is an inside running team, runs a lot of fullback traps early in the game. But I believe this game will be won by defense. Lou Holtz has said it, and the A&M defense has carried this team. A&M's defense, known as the Wrecking Crew, is a quick, determined group that have held the Aggies together this year. Led by the Blitz Brothers, All-American linebacker John Roper and Aaron Wallace, they take away the outside and put incredible pressure on the quarterback.
Their defense very comparable to the University of Miami, which shut us out. So as I look at our best football game, it'll not be good enough.
Notre Dame's best shot will be to run inside behind All-American center Chuck Lanza and try to move Samuel Bryant out of the middle. And that is no easy job. In contrast, Notre Dame's defense is a solid run-stuff defense featuring not a great defensive front, but four quality linebackers. Jackie Sherrill's A&M team will try to spread them out, use the Aggie speed, and make Notre Dame defend the whole field.
We're going to have to try to get to the corner. You know, they're real big. Big defensive line and real big linebackers, and with Woodside and Lewis, you know, running the sweeps and try to throw a few options in there. I think if we can get to the corner, we can be effective.
So the challenge for Notre Dame today will be to defend the corners and take away the big play from A&M, a team that had 11 plays of 50 this season.
There is also a change over on the Notre Dame sideline. We will not see defensive coordinator Foge Fazio standing close to Lou.
I think it's an important move. He will be up in the press box, and you win bowl games by adjustments, and that's why he's in the press box.
Okay, so Foge Fazio will be upstairs. The captains now will be coming down the tunnel to the middle of the field. They'll be having the coin flip, and then we'll be ready with the start of the 52nd annual Cotton Bowl from Dallas, Texas, in just a moment. Three Fighting Irish of Notre Dame taking on the 9-2 Aggies of Texas A&M, and here come the Irish. For the third straight time, the Aggies of Texas A&M come to Dallas as the winners of the Southwest Conference. Aggies win the coin toss. They will defend the goal. Our officials are from the Southeastern Conference. All of them. Dick Burleson will be your referee, and Harold Johnson is your umpire in that crew here this afternoon. They will be the two main men. Referee wearing the white cap. Let's go downstairs to John Dockery. Doc?
You know, Brent, nowhere in the country is a student body more behind their team than the Texan A&M student body. It's a 12-man tradition where the student body will stand for the entire game. A tradition of readiness that goes back to 1922 when E. King Gill came out of the press box and actually went down to help an injury-riddled Aggie team along the sidelines. The student body will stand for the entire game. As I mentioned, they'll wave their 12th man towels. Jackie Sherrill hopes he won't need their help today. Now back to you, Brent.
All right, John, as we see the loyal travelers here backing the Fighting Irish, it'll be the Heisman Trophy winner to open this game against the 12th man. Tim Brown, one of the more dangerous kickoff return men in all of football, comes back home for the Cotton Bowl. And Pat, tell us about the tradition of the 12th man for Jackie Sherrill and Texas A&M.
Well, what Jackie Sherrill did a few years ago when he came to A&M is he got volunteers out of the student body to come down and be on his 12th man, the kickoff team, the punt team, and the kickoff coverage team. So it's an interesting matchup, a Heisman Trophy winner against some regular old students, they say.
The spirit of Aggieland. Reveille in the background. Weather conditions, 37 degrees on the chilly side, and there is a wind to deal with. The passing game could be affected here. A note about the spirit of Aggieland. When Lou Holtz was the head coach at Arkansas, and he was for 7 years, and they would sing that song whenever he was in College Station, he always asked for a penalty. And I couldn't help but notice that Lou Holtz was out stalking the referee here at the Cotton Bowl.
He had a long chat, and rightfully so. His team was standing out there for an awfully long time.
And now his Heisman Trophy winner gets an opportunity against the 12th man.
Brent, I think this is one of the great traditions in college football, this 12th man of A&M. They treat them a little differently. As a matter of fact, they stayed in a separate hotel. They wouldn't let them in with the regular guys.
They sound like fighter pilots on a carrier. Keep them away from the rest of the crew. Feed them red beef and whatever they want and turn them loose. We are underway in the 52nd Cotton Bowl, and here comes your Heisman Trophy winner. He's got an alley out near the 40-yard line, where Terry Andrzejczyk will put it in play for Lou Holtz and the Fighting Irish after a 36-yard return by Tim Brown. Andrzejczyk will lead the way after missing seven games with a separated collarbone. A very good fullback in Johnson. Green, a talented tailback. Brown, of course, the main man. Reggie Ward must fill in as a blocker. The offensive line brings Andrzejczyk up for first and 10 at the Irish 40. They go right straight ahead on that defense, using Johnson on into the middle against Batista's in there against Adam Bob. And right now, let's meet that line. Chuck Lanza, the All-American center, and he is flanked by Tom Freeman and Jeff Pearson as Pearson returns to the starting lineup today. Raider and Spruill are the big tackles, and Andy Heck celebrating his 21st birthday at tight end. Tim Brown split out into the slot now against that defense. And again, they're going right straight ahead. And that time, Adam Bob, 24, made the tackle.
Because A&M blitzes and takes a lot of chances on defense, they put great pressure on the outside of the formation. Notre Dame feels they have to run the ball inside against guys like Samuel Bryant and Bloom and Price, the inside tackles.
Bob, who made the tackle there with Dana Batiste on the inside. And there they are, the Blitz brothers, 83 and 23. And they can really... is third and short for the Irish. Back split. Johnson gets the first down.
Three straight plays now. Notre Dame has come out and run the fullback. They run traps more than just about anybody in college football. The Notre Dame guards are some of the best trapping guards you will see. It takes great timing and quickness off of the offensive guards. The last of the defense of the Aggies.
They're going to make this. I called it a first down, and perhaps I spoke prematurely, Pat. You're headed by about half a football. You're always careful on New Year's morning before you call half a football. The secondary, and there's a big change here. Washington and Morris are on the corners, but back at safety, Corrington, their team leader, but Jones at corner replaces Brooks. And Pat, where and how will they miss Brooks?
Well, they'll miss him in the man-for-man coverage because they blitz so much. They like to use man-to-man, and it's going to be Gary Jones now against Tim Brown.
Irish have attacked the middle of the defense so far. Now Andrzejczyk to throw his first pass down the middle to Brown, complete. Down at the 20-yard line, and Washington, Nicky Washington, brings him down, but a 29-yard gain. Pat, he appeared to be wide open.
And Tim Brown is in the slot receiver, and what you want to do when you have a receiver with great speed like Tim Brown, get in the ball on the move. It's a crossing route where he can catch it and keep going. See, after the catch, he still picks up another 8 or 10 yards. But it's a big lift for Andrzejczyk, his first throw in about 2 months.
Pat Jones, the cornerback, had him as a strong safety, and he turned upfield on him. Now they run Green inside the 20-yard line. This will leave the Irish with second and long as Dana Batiste, number 48, pounds him.
What Notre Dame wants to do is attack in the center of the defense right in here. You're going to see these offensive guards doing a lot of trapping and pulling and blocking in here to clear the way for the fullback. There, that time Freeman made the trap block, but Batiste was right there to make a stop.
Ball is at the Aggie 19 on this second and long. Andrzejczyk on the option cuts up, but he could not get away from the corner who came up. And Adam Bob, the linebacker, number 24, responsible for that tackle. The corner wouldn't let him get outside. He did great run support on that left side as Andrzejczyk checks with Coach Holt.
Well, it's important, I think, for Terry Andrzejczyk to start off quickly, which he did with that big pass. That's got to give him worlds of confidence. When you come into a game like this, you're really not certain how you're going to play after having been injured and been laid off for so long, but he looks very confident to me.
Third and 7 on this play. He's got time. Complete to Brown. Battling toward the end zone. Touchdown, Notre Dame. Waddle to attempt the extra point as Tim Brown sets it up with a great kickoff return, catches two passes, including the one for the touchdown. And the Irish score first. They lead Texas A&M 7-0.
Notre Dame ran a little screen pick play down here. Tim Brown, number 81 right there, running a little delay. You see the other receiver clear out the tight end that was Heck. Again, Brown on the crossing route, a smart move because he's very good after he catches the ball. Give that guy a chance, really, to run after the ball. And, you know, he's so strong. He's almost 200 pounds. He runs right through Corrington, number 10. He sees the end zone and puts it in.
The Heisman Trophy winner returns home to Dallas. Him in Dallas, and Notre Dame strikes first. The Irish lead the Texas A&M 7-0. Waddle with the ball on the tee, and the Aggies have a great return man, too, in Harris. Going to go out of bounds. It'll be a 5-yard penalty. So Harris will be able to move up close to the 10-yard line. At the top of the broadcast, you heard Tim Brown in his own words say he was coming home and he wanted to explode. And as Pat Hayden and I look outside of the announce booth at about 11 o'clock, maybe a couple of miles from here, we see Woodrow Wilson High School, where he grew up, played ball, and what an irony that he's the second Heisman Trophy winner to come from that high school.
Davey O'Brien played there years before him, but Tim Brown wanted to have, he realizes obviously this is his last collegiate game for Notre Dame. It's very important when you're a senior to play well, particularly in your hometown, a January 1 bowl game, particularly after the tough years he went through early in his career at Notre Dame.
So the penalty is assessed to the Irish, ball teed up at the 30. They keep it away from Harris, but this will be superb field position. The Aggies will have it at the 43 as Lafayette Turner, the backup defensive back, hauls it back. Let's meet this Texas A&M offense. Bucky Richardson, he features the option attack. He's got a very talented blocking back as a fullback in Gurley. Woodside the breakaway. There's Rod Harris. He's the deep threat, and Gary Oliver Moore, the control receiver. So the Aggies, first possession now. They trail it by 7. Oliver in motion. And Richardson to throw on first down. He's going to try to get it back on the first play. Incomplete. He wanted Harris. And Harris was well covered by Brandy Wells.
We have seen that play all year long by option teams. When the quarterback fakes the option, comes down the line of scrimmage, and then drops back. Now, the free safety, if this play is going to work, the free safety has to be fooled, but it was not. Brandy Wells, number 5, was back there in actually a double zone coverage and clearly was not fooled. It actually looked like he bumped him. I think that probably should have been interference against Brandy Wells.
The Aggie 43, second and 10. Woodside, first carry to the short side. He's got a first down. Southall pushed him out of bounds. But it was a 12-yard run by Woodside as they attacked the perimeter of the Irish defense.
A&M has the advantage at speed, and that's exactly what they want to do, is get to the outside. Keith Woodside is one of the best outside runners in the Southwest Conference. He's a hunt and peck runner, great runner to the outside, and a terrific receiver out of the backfield as well.
First and 10 at the Irish 46. Pullback, Gurley. They attack the inside of that defense, and John Foley, starting a defensive tackle, number 49, tackles it. Well, along with Pat Hayden and John Dockery, I'm Brent Musburger. Welcome to the 52nd Cotton Bowl in Dallas, Texas. Notre Dame scoring with its first possession, leading Texas A&M, the champions of the Southwest, 7-0. This is a second and 5. Richardson, a good option runner, another first down, and inside the 30-yard line.
Bucky Richardson is only a freshman, but he plays like a senior. He's just a tough, physical runner. He's a big guy, 205 runners, pounds. You know, it's hard when he runs the option, because even though you have him well defended, he's supposed to run outside, but boom, he'll cut it right back inside. He's almost like an I-back, at quarterback because he'll take that option right over the center or over the guard.
Ball is on the Irish 30. Figaro returns, replacing Stams at linebacker. It's Gurley again. He battles inside the 15. A very good first down behind this offensive line, which is doing a job right now. Outstanding center in Matt Wilson. In fact, the center and these two guards are the heart of it. Webb and Fontenot, and they've attacked well early. Matt McCall, the freshman, moves in, and Sylvester Morgan is the tight end. Now, of course, Jackie Sherrill has robbed two players who signed with an agent illegally. Brantley, a starting tackle, and Collins, a backup fullback. Now it's Woodside, tripped up. Great defensive play by Smigala. Number 29, Stan Smigala, the 5'11 sophomore defensive back, came up and made the hit.
One way to stop a team from running outside is running from some blitzes on the short side. Number 29, Smigala, is the short side defensive corner. He is on a blitz this time, forces it right back inside and makes the play on Woodside. But you're going to have to blitz to stop the outside play.
Now this is the test of a quarterback. Third and six, and the Aggies have hit only 34% on third down. Richardson, good protection. Sidelines, got Oliver out of bounds. No completion. They ruled he was out of bounds.
And that's a terrific hit there by Smigala, who's been very, very physical here there in the first quarter. He has to come down with a foot in bounds, but Smigala hits him and carries him out. You still have to come down. It's not the rule in college football that if you get pushed out, it's a completion.
If they kick it, it'll be a 42-yarder. I say if in bowl games, you're never sure. Slater is a big-time field goal kicker, however. And the wind was pushing it, and he doesn't get it. Notre Dame stays ahead of Texas A&M. 7-0. The Irish, second possession, coming up. Seven games because of that separated shoulder. And we asked him what the biggest adjustment was upon his return.
I think the biggest adjustment I had to make was trying to be back, get the leadership role back. You know, from they're so used to the quarterbacks in the previous games that I lost that leadership role. And I came in, I had to, you know, make adjustments with my own self to overcome that and be a better leader out here and get accepted again.
You know, Brent, I talked to a lot of his players yesterday, particularly the offensive linemen. They love his leadership. They are very happy to have him back.
Starts at the 26, two new running backs. Banks and Brooks are behind him. This is Brooks, one of the freshmen. He was Adam Bob hitting first over there. Number 24, the junior inside linebacker, very active for Sherrill so far early.
Off the corner, too, you're going to see Alex Morris, number 30. He is the short side corner, too. He comes up and supports, forces Brooks inside where he gets hit by Adam Bob. This is a tremendous defense by A&M. They are a blitzing, stunning, twisting team. They'll give you pressure from anywhere on the field.
Brown comes in with the play, and they slot him to the right. Zepp pulls out, looks for him. He's got him again. His third completion and another Notre Dame first down. He is now in this game accounted for 95 yards, all purpose, and that ties what he did against Miami in the last game of the season.
Well, you can see what Notre Dame is just a much better team when they can throw the ball effectively with Andrew Zapp. It just gives them a completely different dimension, particularly when you can get the ball to a guy like Tim Brown. They're not going to throw the ball a lot more today, just better.
Now again, they're keeping him in the slot. Here he is to Andrzak's left. Backed up and took it and managed to squeeze a couple of yards, but he had to retreat for that pass before he could turn it upfield. Tim Brown's high school coach is downstairs with John Dr. Duck.
Thank you, Brent. This is Richard Mason. And coach, what was Tim Brown, what did he do for you in high school?
John, he did just about anything we asked him to. He played quarterback, wide receiver, he even played free safety and strong safety on defense.
When did you first know he was a great athlete?
The first time that we played him as a junior, he returned the opening kickoff. I think it was 95 yards for a touchdown.
Well, thank you, Coach. Okay, Brent, back to you.
All right, John, and we saw Brown limp off to the sideline. It didn't appear to be serious. Andrzejczyk, it's number three, Alonzo Jefferson, the senior receiver who is 5'7". He suffered a major knee injury a couple of seasons ago against Michigan.
Well, here's the hit on Tim Brown that may have hurt him. Again, this A&M defense really rallies to the football. Look, anything terrible there, to be perfectly honest, but he is limping around a little bit.
Andrzejczyk, 5 of 5 for 67 yards. So the decision to start him at quarterback working out for Lou Holtz and his staff at least so far.
Every completion, though, has gone to the slot man in the formation. A&M is going to have to double the slot receiver.
Padded his third and short here for the Irish. They show the power eye with the two tight ends. And Andrzejczyk gets the first down out to midfield against the Aggies. Pat, how are they keeping Roper and Wallace out of the game so far? We have not even heard the Blitz Brothers' name.
You're right. They're keeping a tight end in from time to time to block John Roper. And then on the backside, it's usually either a guard or the tackle that slide blocks and takes out Aaron Wallace. But you always have to be concerned about running those guys running the play down from the backside.
Do the Irish look a lot different to you offensively with Andrzejczyk?
They absolutely, when they can throw the ball like this to Tim Brown and some of the other receivers, they're a much more dangerous and effective team.
Now they run Brooks, and there's a great defensive play. Coming in was Dana Batiste, the junior inside linebacker.
Dana Batiste is one of the unsung players on this defense. At the left top, watch him fill the hole with so much outside pressure that A&M come to it. The inside guys also are very good blitzers as well. You see, he read the guard pull or step down right away, was in the hole to put the stop on Waters before he had anywhere to go. Good read by Batiste.
Ricky Waters at tailback and Tim Brown returns. He is slotted there to the left. Andrzejczyk going deep down the middle to his tight end, and heck, almost had it. What a great defensive play by Mickey Washington. Got a hand on the ball and knocked it away.
Well, the play selection by Notre Dame is much, much different than we have seen all season long. That's the first time we've seen the tight end, Andy Heck, go deep all year long. But Mickey Washington, number one, was not fooled, had him very well covered. Did a nice job of knocking the ball away from Heck.
Now it is a third and long. J.C. Slocum, the defensive coordinator, likes to do what in this situation, Pat?
Here is where John Roper and Aaron Wallace are most dangerous.
Andrzejczyk, under pressure, dropped the screen off, and that's Waters. Waters turns the corner, does not have the first down. So against that expected pressure, Lou went for the screen pass.
And you saw Roper, they let Roper block, let Roper come right in, and it's a terrific call against a blitzing type of defense. But I think Lou Holtz was upset with Waters for not knowing where the first yard marker was and putting his shoulder down and really getting it. Should have cut inside, I think he thought.
So Notre Dame with its second possession into punt formation with Vince Phelan.
And A&M has blocked three punts this year.
Is deep. And it's not a good punt. Down there at the 31-yard line. A 12-yard punt by Phelan. Aggies ball when you come back.
Offenses, I thought this was going to be a much tighter defensive game in the first half, but both offenses have come out and really thrown the ball and been pretty wide open.
Woodside, the tailback. Oliver, the motion man. Richardson again throwing on first down. Whoa, his wide receiver Waddle, who just checked in, was nailed. Stan Smagala is doing a great job back there, and also so is Spence.
That is the third play that Smagala has made. A&M is trying to work on him. He always plays to the short side of the formation. You see all the offensive linemen, this is going to be a quick screen to Waddle, but Smagala beats the block of the tackle and is there to make the play. That's terrific play by Smagala.
Now this puts Texas A&M in second and long. That's not a down that Richardson and the Aggies like in this situation. They'll try Woodside and go for the left corner. Woodside battles out with a tough run to the 35-yard line, and Marv Spence brings him down on that side.
Now, Brent, some guys just fondle their blockers well, and Keith Woodside is one of those kind of guys. On that play, there was just a tiny little crease, and he followed it the whole way and picked up, about 6 or 7 yards. But he has great eyes, not tremendous speed, but follows his blocks and is very patient.
Third down for Richardson and Texas A&M. They split the backs. They put the tight end in motion. Over the middle to him, but incomplete. So for the Aggies of Texas A&M, their sixth appearance here in the Cotton Bowl. Three in a row. Playing Auburn, Ohio State, and here today Notre Dame. Jackie Sherrill took over that program, and he has done a superb job.
They weren't favored, really, to come back this year. This team was supposed to be here next year.
Stump, a low punt. Tim Brown lets it bounce, and he'll let it roll dead, and they'll down it inside the five. Tim Brown probably should have pounced on it, but there is a penalty marker down back on the Aggie 35-yard line. It goes as a 64-yard punt, but there is a penalty marker down. Great punt. It'll stand. Anders Eck will be coming out from his own 2-yard line.
Boy, and we talked at the top of the show, Brent, about how special teams can really be the influence of on a game like this. When you have what you think is going to be a close game, a big play by the special teams can be the difference.
Well, tomorrow, great NCAA basketball, Florida against Pittsburgh at 2:30 Eastern time. That'll be a dandy. And then after that, CBS Sports Saturday coming your way. We'll have an NABF middleweight championship bout, and they'll also have a roundtable discussion of the upcoming NFL playoffs. Anthony Johnson and Mark Green will be the Irish running backs with Andrew Zek, number two, coming into the huddle. And they run Johnson out to the 6-yard line.
You're getting prepared for bowl games. I think adjustments have more to do with winning bowl games than just about anything else, because you had so much time to prepare for the game. Coming into the game, Notre Dame ran the ball 78% of the time. Today, they've run 9 times and passed 7. Really changed it up.
Tim Brown to the right slot. Terrell outside him. Colts prefers to keep it on the ground. Adam Bob makes the hit on Johnson.
Big game by Adam Bob, the inside linebacker, number 24 right here. And one of the things that reasons he is so effective, because the guys on the outside collapse everything and force you to run inside. If he can just defeat the block of the guard, he is there to make the play. And he has done that 3 times so far today.
Jackie Sherrill likes those tough linebackers.
Well, he's got 4 good ones. He likes guys who are mean and tough and nasty. And 2 good ones on the outside, and Bob's had a pretty good game on the inside.
Just like he was when he played. Anders Eck will roll under pressure, incomplete. Adam Bob went after him and delivered the lick in the end zone and forced him to throw in a hurry.
Both inside linebackers that time came on the blitz. Adam Bob is right here, and Batiste is right here. Batiste gets taken down, but Bob is there to make the pressure. It was a little cross. You see Batiste 48 gets buried, but Bob comes clean and makes Andrzak throw the ball before he wanted to. Good coordination by the linebacker.
Aggies show 10 men on that line against the Phelan punt. And Harris driven back near midfield. Bob is it. Coming to the perimeter. Down at the 40-yard line. Good field position coming up for Texas A&M. That's a 42-yard punt and a 10-yard return by Harris.
Well, we talked about Tim Brown returning punts, but Rod Harris has returned 2 punts for touchdowns himself this year. An All-Southwest Conference performer as a wide receiver, too. This A&M team really changed its character when Bucky Richardson became the quarterback in about the fifth game of the year. They became very much a running football team. Before that, over the last 2 years, they've been a finesse and a passing football team.
Now they come with Lewis at tailback. And off of the fake, the ball, 35-yard line, Ned Volkar. Coming up for the hit for Lou Holtz. Let's go downstairs to John Dockery.
Thank you, Brent. And the wind is beginning to whip up from left to right a little more down here. And remember Lou Holtz telling us he was a little bit concerned about Terry Andrzak's arm strength, that the wind started to whip up. Well, it's beginning to. It affected that punt somewhat, as you saw. But there's only 2:32 left, and then it'll change, of course, and Andrzak will have the win. Now back to you, Brent.
A personal foul has been called against Holtz and the Fighting Irish. They hit the head of the quarterback. And it was spearing was the call. So a spearing call moves it down to the 20-yard line.
And it's the right part of the screen where you're going to see the spear come from. There's actually two spears there. It was a good call by the official. Can't use the helmet as a weapon.
Now the umpire steps in and stops things. We've got 2:23 to go here in the first quarter. Notre Dame leading Texas A&M 7-0, but the Aggies moving within striking distance. And Early, the fullback, comes right straight ahead behind his center and his two guards. Mike Griffin, the nose man, brings him down.
You mentioned the center, Matt Wilson from A&M, number 50, has had a terrific year for the Aggies as an All-Southwest Conference performer. He makes all the line calls, and I've never heard a coach tell me that a center is a big play guy. Jackie Sherrill said that about Matt Wilson, the center for the Aggies.
Now, this is a second and seven for the Aggies. Woodside back there as the lone setback. Richardson is a superb runner. Gets to the 11-yard line. Had an opportunity to ask young Richardson, who's limping a bit, where he was a year ago.
Thought this time last year, I thought I would be at LSU, you know, on the scout team, but it didn't work out like that, and I chose to come to A&M, and it's really worked out for me.
No use backing up Tom Hodson when you can start in a Cotton Bowl.
Well, that, as we said earlier, they planned actually to redshirt him, but his first two plays were for 18 yards and 83 yards early in the year. They realized they had a plan.
First down. They had to get to the 10, and Gurley got beyond it for the Aggie first down. Pritchett brings him down, one of the inside linebackers.
Again, it was Matt Wilson, the center, and the right guard, Fontenot, who really created just a little bit of a seam there for Gurley to pick up the first down. Gurley's an ex-linebacker, 210 pounds, strong inside runner, and a very good block.
On the first and goal, here's Woodside. And a good defensive play by John Foley. Foley came to Notre Dame as a linebacker out of the Chicago area, and against Miami, they started using him as a down lineman. They liked him so much when they reviewed the films that they have put him to that spot. Coach Fazio also has altered his entire defensive concept for this game. You're watching much more of a gap defense on the part of the Irish here this afternoon than before. And Coach is upstairs in the press box watching how things unfold. And all year he's been on the sideline next to Lou. Off the play action, Richardson is hit as he delivers. And it was Brandy Wells who came and got him.
This is the third time that Notre Dame has done this. They did not do that much this year, but remember, they had a month to prepare for this football game. Obviously, it is confused A&M, the blitz from the corner. That time, Brandy Wells from the right side. Richardson never saw him. It's just one of those things, Brent, about getting ready for a bowl game. You can have so many change-ups that you didn't have in the course of the season.
Now, Pat, it's third and goal. Woodside, a good receiver, is over on the left wing. Incomplete. Ball was thrown high. Courtney Southall came over.
Good pass protection here for Richardson, but very good coverage by Southall as well as Wells and Spence back deep. You see, Richardson has pretty good time. Good pass route, a crossing route, which is good inside the 20-yard line because most teams play man-for-man coverage, but Southall was right there.
There's the field goal by Slater. So he's one for two, and the Aggies are on the board. Come to the end of the first period. Notre Dame leading Texas A&M 7-3. And we'll return after this message and a word from your local station. New year, everybody. We're at the Cotton Bowl Classic in Dallas. Notre Dame leading Texas A&M 7-3. And Tim Brown scored the Irish touchdown on a 17-yard pass from quarterback Terry Andrzejczyk. And we may see him in action here again. Set to return another kickoff. Working against the 12th man, the walk-on kickoff team of the Aggies. They elect to go elsewhere. And this is Banks, and he'll lateral it to the Heisman Trophy winner. Down at the 30-yard line. I guess if they stop him short of midfield, it's considered some accomplishment. I want to stress the time for you folks on Sunday when we start the wild card coverage. High noon Eastern time. Down in New Orleans. It's going to be a great, great scene. That's 11 o'clock here in Dallas. Vikings and the Saints. You want to see that one. How good are these Saints? Right now, how good are these Aggie defensive players? They come with Banks, the fullback. Wallace, number 23, one of the defensive players in on that stop. Let's go downstairs to John Dockery.
Thank you, Brent. I'm with injured Chet Brooks, a man who would have been responsible for Tim Brown. Chet, would have been different with you in there?
I think so, because I'm pretty aggressive, and I think Tim Brown is not the type. He's a finesse receiver. He's not going to go jaw-to-jaw with you. And I think if our defense back can get a little more aggressive, you know, they'll fare better with him.
Why the problems early with Tim coming across the middle?
They're letting him run free. Nobody's banging him. The linebackers are not, you know, trying to jam him or nothing. He's finding open spots. Quarterback's going to get it to him.
Thank you, Chet. Get well.
Incomplete, intended for Terrell. Washington on the coverage. Let me just follow up what Brooks said, because Pat, you and I watched him in action on tape. What did you think about his assessment of being a tough physical defensive back?
There is no doubt about it. What he does is really chuck the receiver before he gets off the line of scrimmage. What we have seen today is Tim Brown run free, get his momentum up as he crosses over the middle.
He was the fireman or the blitzer in that defensive backfield for the Aggies, too. So they're going to miss him a lot. This is third and five now for Andrzejczyk and the Irish. Off the play action. Drop it over to the tight end. First down. Heck gets the first down for Notre Dame. They stay alive.
This is a completely different offense we are seeing from Notre Dame today than they did play in the last 7 weeks. We had an opportunity to watch Notre Dame, but with Terry Andrzejczyk at quarterback, they're a much better football team, clearly much more diversified. Watch the fake here to Mark Green. Now the tight end, Heck, just runs a delay route. You see all the linebackers run off with a wide receiver. Heck waits on the delay and picks up the ball for the first down. That's a good call on third and six.
And the ball out at the 41-yard line to start this series. They run the draw play with Banks. Big hit by Dana Batiste, number 48.
Notre Dame, for an eye football team, gets more production out of the fullback than any team, I think, in college football. That time, of course, it was splitbacks. But even out of the eye formation, Notre Dame will use their fullbacks inside on bellies and traps more than any other eye team I've seen this year.
Now it is second and long. Here's where the Aggies like to put you. For J.C. Slocum's defensive unit. Andrzejczyk pulls straight back against it. Forced out of the pocket. He'll throw back for Heck. A great grab for a first down by the tight end.
Andy Heck has only caught five passes the entire year. They've gone to him three times already today. Heck is primarily a blocker. Bottom of the screen, number 85, is Andy Heck. You're going to see him right down here on the delay as Andrzak buys himself a little bit more time. He's supposed to be a blocker, but he sees Andrzak in trouble. And then that's nice touch there by Andrzak to find Heck.
Andrzak, 8 of 11 for 97 yards. And now he throws the swing pass to Green, and Green's got an alley inside the 25, inside the 20-yard line. A 25-yard gain on the swing from Andrzak to Green.
And what a diversified offense we're seeing. We've seen them throw the ball deep downfield to Terrell just a moment ago. And we've seen them throw the ball over the middle, draw plays, and now the little dump pass. Watch Freeman, number 65, make a nice block here that helps Green as he cuts inside of that. Good vision by Green there.
The Blitz brothers have been missing in action so far. It's first down for Notre Dame at the Aggie 19. Here's Banks up the middle. And that time, O'Brien, the nose man, got in behind him.
Brent, one of the reasons I think that Roper and Allen Wallace have not been in Andrzak's face is because they've gotten rid of the ball so quickly. Andrzak is not holding on the ball in the pocket for very long and giving Roper and Wallace a chance.
Johnson returns at fullback for the Irish. Here's the second and 10. And Andrzak will use a timeout at this point in the game. That's probably a pretty good idea. He'll confer with Coach Holtz, who calls the plays over there on the Notre Dame sideline, and we'll be right back. We're talking about this young man, Kip Corrington, all A's and one B. During his school years at Texas A&M, and what did he get that B in, Pat?
I think it was English literature since 1870, I believe.
This is second and 10 now for the Irish. Andrzak sets the screen and almost threw the interception. Aaron Wallace had a hand on the ball. That's his first badly thrown pass of the day.
For a screen to work, you have to be able to cut down the outside linebacker. Aaron Wallace does a nice job of fighting off the block with his hand. You see him right there fighting off the block? If he had been cut, that screen would have worked. But Wallace refused to go down and then almost made the interception.
And Slocum had Alex Morris blitzing on that play, too, to apply pressure. Now it's third and 10 against this Aggie defense. Andrzak keeps it off the option. And this will set up a field goal attempt for Grotto. The Aggie defense with a great series down there. That was John Roper, 83, delivering the blow against Holtz.
Always have to be worried about the backside when you have the speed of Roper. He is 225 pounds and runs 4.6. It's just phenomenal to me.
It's a critical defensive series. The Irish were on the move. Now it's a 36-yard attempt. Low, but good. The line drived it over, didn't he?
That may have been tipped by Gary Jones.
Well, we'll take a look at it while you're away, and then we'll come back. We're at the Cotton Bowl. Happy New Year, everybody, from Dallas, Texas. Get it?
No, bottom right part of the screen. Gary Jones puts on a tremendous rush, but he did not tip the kick. Grotto just kind of squibbed it. It was a low one, but did get through.
And it gives Notre Dame a 10-3 lead. We have 10:52 to go here in the first half. Harris at the 8. Great move by Harris. Battles his way out to the 30-yard line. Let's go downstairs to John Dockery. Doc?
Thank you, Brent. Something might bear watching. A few plays ago, you might recall Tim Brown was out of the game. Well, the reason he came out of the game was to put this heavy back plaster on his back. His team gathered around him while he dropped his pants so that he could put this on. Apparently his back was bothering him, and he wants to keep it warm. It might bear watching as it gets cooler and as the game goes on to see if it stiffens up. Now back to you, Brent.
All right, John. Lewis back at tailback. He's replaced Woodside. Richardson, the keeper, on the option. And Figueroa brings him down from behind as he crosses the 35.
Yeah, what makes Richardson so difficult to defend on the option, he just does not run where you're supposed to run. You're supposed to get all the way outside when you're running that option play, but he has the tendency to be a cutback runner as a quarterback. A&M has had excellent field position all day to start drives. The average field position when they've started has been on their own 41.
Waddle is the wide receiver to the right. They now pull the tight end off the line and they hand to Lewis, the freshman, getting close to that first down.
Darren Lewis, a year ago, was being recruited by A&M and watched this game from the stands as being recruited. He's got tremendous speed, but you can clock that, those things, you can measure those things. But what they found out about Darren Lewis, he's awfully tough. He's a strong inside runner, and he's got a lot of heart. You can't measure that by the clock. I think if you told Jackie Sherrill that he would start a freshman quarterback and have a tailback Darren Lewis be an integral part of his offense and be in the Cotton Bowl, you think he would have laughed at you a year ago?
Next year, both these teams are going to be excellent. This is first and 10 at the 39 for the Aggies. That's the fullback in motion. And again, Richardson down the line, slipping up inside. He got close to a first down with that carry.
You know, we really thought that A&M was going to be running outside an awful lot. They've run one play outside by design and seven plays inside. A lot of that has been the cutbacks by Richardson on the option.
And they can credit Blair Thomas for this game plan. And I hear somebody say, what are you talking about? When they broke down that Penn State film, they found that many of those yards were on cutback runs. And they have stressed cutback against this Irish defense for the last 2 weeks. Now Richardson rolling out here, and you can see how quick he is trying to get to the perimeter. That was George Streeter bringing him down for Notre Dame. But it's a first down for the Aggies.
This was a mix-up in the backfield. I think Richardson was trying to hand the ball off, but he looked, and nobody was there to get it. So then he took off on his own, and he is not a wimp. He is going to try to deliver a blow. He's only a freshman, 18 years old. He will learn the lesson.
Were you a wimp with
Absolutely.
The Rams in USC?
Of course I was. Of course I was. Why do you think I'm here?
All right. First and 10 now for the Aggies. They're down at the Irish 47, trailing it by a touch. Here's Lewis. He'll get to the outside, but no further than the 45-yard line as Marv Spence brings him down.
And that defense, that play was stopped because Cedric Figueroa really tied up the tight end of A&M and really forced Darren Lewis to make up take too much time making his decision. Watch the right guard. He's going to pick up Ned Bolkar, number 47. That's what he has to do. A guard has to have good eyes just like a tailback does because he has man-for-man blocking. As soon as he sees that linebacker, he goes out and blocks him.
Richardson pitches this time. Woodside, who's back in the game, tackled by Streeter. Streeter up from the secondary. Brown trying to keep that back loose over on the far side here on the Cotton Bowl. This leaves the Aggies with a third and long.
You know, Brent, it looks like Notre Dame has borrowed something from the A&M defensive scheme, too. We talked about them using the gap defense, but they're also blitzing an awful lot more than they ordinarily do. That time, George Streeter, the strong safety, came on a quick blitz.
Now the Aggies slot Oliver to the right. Richardson rolls in that direction. Harris with a great catch, but out of bounds. Ruled no good. And that was Marv Spence delivering the blow in that Irish secondary, number 25.
The problem with running an outcut when you're running a sprint out pass, it just takes too long. By the time really the receiver has the ball thrown to him, he's too close to the sideline. So the receiver really has to cut his split down to give the quarterback enough room to throw the out route.
Richardson, 1 of 7, minus 4 yards passing. Stump, one of their three quarterbacks, to punt it. Hits a line drive over Brown's head, and it'll go into the end zone and come out at the 20-yard line. 47-yard punt by Stump. Notre Dame leading Texas A&M 10-3. We'll be right back to Dallas. Pressure rated 12th, and the Aggies 13th. Over in the UPI coaches poll, it's reversed. The Aggies are ahead of the Irish. Right now, Notre Dame leads it 10-3. This is a first and 10. Play fake by Andrzejczyk. He has good time. Throws complete to Brown. And Brown to the 42-yard line. A 22-yard pass, Andrzejczyk to Brown. He was wide open again.
And it was excellent protection by the Notre Dame offensive line that allowed Andrzejczyk to find Brown. Watch how much time he's going to get. Remember, see the tackle, number 76, Raider? He just takes Wallace, who's the great pass rusher, out of the game. Pushes him way inside. By that time, Andrzejczyk had plenty of time to find Brown. That's terrific protection by Raider.
That's five catches for the Heisman Trophy winner and 81 yards. Showing you here today why the pros think so highly of him. Andrzejczyk to throw again, and it's complete to Brown. Brown inside the 35-yard line before Jones can wrap him up. That's 23 more yards for Brown.
And one reason they put Tim Brown in the slot is because it's more difficult to double cover a receiver when he's in the slot. Here's a little combination route. The wide receiver goes deep. Tim Brown follows him, then just falls right into the dead spot, and then the arm strength of Andrzejczyk gets him the ball. But very difficult, or more difficult, to double cover the slot receiver.
Now it's Johnson, the fullback. Roper cleans up. Go downstairs to John Dockery. Doc?
Thank you, Brent. I'm here with Tim Brown's brother, and Tim looks sharp today.
He really does. I tell you what, the rest has really helped him a lot this week. The last 3 weeks has gave him a chance to rest that shoulder. He's doing real good today.
You know, I have to ask you another thing, Don, because I know you're involved in the decision. It came down to Notre Dame and SMU. Why ND?
ND offered some academic opportunity that no one else did. And the final analysis, the family just decided Notre Dame was the best place to be.
And it certainly turned out well, didn't it?
It has been absolutely marvelous. You couldn't ask for a better homecoming. Tim is having a great game. I don't know what more you can ask for.
Okay, congratulations. Now back up to you, Brent.
Well, what a great decision that was. When you consider all of the unfortunate things that have happened to SMU, well, Tim Brown's career handled well by his family. I'll tell you one member of that family who has not seen him play, and that's his mother, and she's not watching today. Folks, she's never seen him play. He told her he was a member of the band when he was in high school. She's home cooking.
She won't even watch the replay. She's afraid he's going to get hurt.
Andrzejczyk zips one for a first down. That's the other wide receiver, Reggie Ward.
And that's a nice call, too, because finally the A&M defense has given Tim Brown a lot more attention. And when you play on the other side of Tim Brown, you ought to have a field day. But believe it or not, the wide receivers that play on the other side of Brown have only caught five passes all year long.
Terry Andrzejczyk giving his impression of Phil Simms in the Super Bowl here this afternoon. I can hear Notre Dame fans all across the country saying, oh, why didn't we have him against Penn State and Miami? First and 10 now for the Irish. The ball is at the Aggie 20-yard line. They run Johnson, the fullback. He is wrapped up on that side. Wallace, 23, was there. Adam Bob, 24. They were the two defensive players.
Well, Terry Andrzejczyk may very well be back next year at Notre Dame, even though he is a senior. He has written a letter to the administration at Notre Dame asking to reclaim a year of eligibility his freshman year when he only played in the first game and was injured. That decision will be made by the Notre Dame faculty and staff, but they'd love to have him back considering the way he's playing.
Andrzejczyk steps back out of trouble again, fires to the end zone, and knocked away at the last instant.
That's intercepted. That was intercepted by number 30, Alex Morris, who did a terrific job of not only getting in position to make the play, but then making the catch and keeping his feet in bounds.
What a great play he makes.
But again, watch the penetration early. This play was messed up early on because of the penetration by Batiste, number 48. 30 Morris is behind the receiver a little bit, but drives on the ball, makes a one-handed catch, and keeps the feet in bounds. Terrific play by Morris.
I didn't think there was any way that he could keep his feet in bounds when he touched the ball in the end zone. So Morris, in the game's first turnover.
And Lance Pavelis now is in at quarterback. We said they've used three different quarterbacks this year. He is the thrower.
And right away he goes to it, and it's complete. Coming out of the backfield is Woodside. So Pavlis steps into the game and completes an 11-yarder to Woodside.
And Brent, a year ago, Jackie Sherrill really thought that Lance Pavlos was going to be a terrific quarterback this year. He's a redshirt freshman. He's had a difficult year. Started three games, but was benched earlier. But he is the best thrower of all three of them. Obviously, they're frustrated with the running game.
This is Woodside. Figueroa wraps him up at the 32-yard line.
All three quarterbacks at A&M have come in at one point during the year and won football games for the Aggies. Pavlos was starter early on in the year, came in the Washington game, and led them to a victory. Strong arm kid, highly recruited here in Texas, and they still think he's going to be a very fine player.
Kevin Murray, who quarterbacked them in the last two Cotton Bowls, we watched him working out. He had a plate removed from an injured ankle, and he expects another NFL tryout sometime in the upcoming year. Pavlos throws complete. Oliver breaks away. Smagala at the 35-yard line. It's a 33-yard play, and Pavlos lights a fire for the Aggies.
How many times have you seen this in college football where the backup quarterback comes in and just emotionally lifts his team? This ball is a frozen rope by Pavlos. Good protection inside. Drills the ball to Oliver, who then made a nice little spin. Nate Spence miss him and for the big game. That's a nice play.
First and 10 at the Notre Dame 36-yard line. Now they come getting to the perimeter with Woodside inside the 30-yard line. Randy Wells tackles him. Woodside shaken up on the play. The trainers rush out to his side.
Woodside is probably most affected of any offensive player from A&M this year by the change to the running game because he's such a fine receiver. 110 receptions would set a Southwest Conference record this year.
We'll be right back to the Cotton Bowl. Played his high school football here, and it's good to see that Keith Woodside is all right after being shaken up. The freshman Lewis checks into that backfield. A lot of youngsters on this Texas A&M team. This is going to be a dandy for the next couple of years. You can expect this bunch to contest for a national championship. Pavlos hands to Gurley. He blasts to the 25, and that would give the Aggies still another first down. Jeff Ohm, number 90, playing in that defensive line, brings him down. The difference in the game and the reason why Pavlos has replaced Richardson.
And with Pavlos in the ballgame, this is really the offense that Jackie Sherrill and Lynn Amity, the offensive coordinator from A&M, want to run. It's a finesse offense where they can throw the ball all over the field, and with that defense, that's a pretty tough combination.
Thompson, the wide receiver to Pavlos' left. And Lewis, the left-handed option thrower, wants him. Touchdown, Aggies! Set up here on the extra point, and the line moves over to the middle of the field. Slater. Hammers it through, and A&M ties Notre Dame with 1:42 left in the first half.
Darren Lewis had thrown the ball earlier this year as well, and this is a great call inside the 20-yard line because teams like the blitz down there. See Smagala, number 29, he is the corner who's supposed to be there. But he has got his nose up there trying to stop the run as he did earlier in the game, and Thompson ran right by him.
Is there anything more effective than a left-handed throwing halfback on that option?
Watch Smagala come up and the safety get fooled right here too. The short side of the defense into the boundary where A&M had run earlier. Southall comes right up. Smagala comes up and a terrific call inside the 20-yard line.
Thompson fakes a little post move and a quick step back to the outside and all alone. And on the season, Lewis is 2 of 2 for 2 touchdowns. That's shades of what Walter Payton used to do with the Bears in the NFL.
Well, when your offense is playing like this, too, I think it lifts your defense as well, Brent. I think you'll be a lot more reckless on defense.
Well, that's a couple of great plays. That interception by Morris down there in the end zone was a thing of beauty. How he managed his feet inbounds when he went up on that ball. Now the low kick. Brown's got it at the 8. Weaves his way out to the 29-yard line. Andrew Zeck and the Irish with 1:37 to work with. Dean Berry making the tackle. NFC Wildcard, remember, we'll start at noon Eastern. Normally we start at 12:30, but we go to the playoffs and we'll start a little bit earlier. Noon Eastern time from New Orleans, NFC Wildcard game, Vikings and the Saints.
The Saints are for real, aren't they?
Boy, they sure are. Now it's a first and 10, and Tony Brooks into the Notre Dame backfield. Andrew Zeck with a deep drop to set the screen, and the fullback drops the ball.
That should be A&M's ball. I'm not sure what the officials are taking so long to call.
Well, I think possession is the question, Pat. It's only a question as to did he have control of the ball when he coughed it up. And that's what the conference is. Now the referee wants to confer with members of his crew, someone who had a better view of Banks. Fumble. He had control. Aggies ball. Tony Jones recovers it.
Well, the key here is did Banks have for possession of the ball after their throw here? Couldn't really tell from that angle, although the guy couldn't really tell from that angle.
Now, Bucky Richardson comes back in, indicating that Jackie Sherrill and Lynn Amity, the offensive coordinator, they want to go back to that option running game down here. Richardson, the 360, gets inside the 20, picking up a couple of yards, and Flash Gordon brings him down. How about this view, Pat? Can you tell here?
I think Banks was actually fumbling the ball. He was screened by his back, but it looked like he was fumbling the ball there.
Let me tell you that you'd really need a clear-cut reverse angle to tell. I honestly believe it's pretty impossible to tell. He did pick his head up and look upfield like he might have had possession. At any rate, the officials had a lot better view of it than we did in that situation. Now on second and long, Pavlis back in the game. Hits Woodside inside the 10, first and goal.
Great substituting by the Aggies. They bring in Richardson to run the option play, and then right back with Pavlis on a passing down. We said they've used all three of these quarterbacks at different parts of the season and for different reasons. Obviously, Pavlis is the thrower. Good protection was the key here. He delivers the ball on time. No wasted motion there by Pavlis in getting rid of the football.
And he is 3-of-3 for 55 yards. Now here's Lewis. Cutback. Battles, and he's out of bounds near the 2-yard line. Boy, this has been a well-played football game, hasn't it?
But it was this turnover which really gave A&M the chance to be in scoring position. That's clearly the angle we wanted to see. I don't think he had possession there, but the official there who made the call.
All right. Well, we've got a timeout because of an injury. Let's take a look at these two fine schools. Angle, normal speed.
And at this angle, at normal speed, it's clear that Banks does not have possession. The little screen pass. He turns away. He was fumbling it the whole way, and that's a poor call by the official. He was bobbling it the whole way.
Now, we stress normal speed because if you slow anything down, it'll appear as though almost anybody has possession. But when you show it in normal speed, you get a better indication as to whether or not he had control. Nevertheless, the Aggies get the ball, and now they are threatening to go ahead for the first time in this Cotton Bowl. They are down to the Notre Dame 2-yard line. They have a second and goal. They show full house. Powerful touchdown. A&M leads as Larry Horton goes in. They go ahead for the two off the swinging gate and get it. That was Wally Hartley carrying it in.
A great call by A&M. Now, they line up in the swinging gate after every extra point. They've done it all year long. And if you don't show enough defenders over there, the center's going to snap the ball there to Hartley, as they did right here, and they're just going to power it in.
There's the look they come up with.
I love that.
Go for the two.
And here's a look at Horton, number 39, yet another freshman, and he runs over Matt McCall, the right tackle, number 77, a nice block by him. And Gurley, the fullback, 38, clears the way for Horton as well to get in the end zone.
So the Aggies get a break, an apparent bad call, and they burn the Irish for 8 points. And now in the last 40 seconds, Texas A&M has scored 15 points to take an 18-10 lead. Just inside of a half minute left here in the first half. And Brown moving up near the 14-yard line as Talbot has been kicking those low, sort of bouncing kicks.
You know, A&M has had a remarkable record on two-point plays this year, Brent. They are 6 of 7 on two-point plays. Notre Dame, on the other hand, is only 1 of 6.
This one up. Banks has it at the 25-yard line. And he is down there at the 32-yard line. John Burnett on that 12th man unit goes out after the Irish fullback. Time remaining here in the first half. Eric Parsegan and Jim Nance be coming your way at halftime from the Cotton Bowl here in Dallas.
And Brent, the way that the Irish have been throwing the football, they still have time, really, with two timeouts remaining, to get themselves in a position to kick a field goal. Grottle has kicked a 49-yarder this year, and they have the two timeouts remaining.
Now, they show a three-man rush with Wallace and Roper for the Aggies. Trying to get it, Andrzejczyk. They cannot. Andrzejczyk goes deep, knocked down, and there was Morris again. For my money, he made the biggest play of the first half, that interception down in the end zone when Notre Dame was threatening again.
Alex Morris has done a nice job of blitzing as well, but here on the pass coverage, this ball should not have been thrown. There's three defenders around Tim Brown. The other receiver has got to be open.
Kip Corrington back there along with Washington. They were the other two defensive players. Corrington volleyballing it. Morris feeling that he should have had the interception. Now 14 seconds left here in the first half in Dallas. One set back. That's the fullback Johnson. Andrzejczyk will run the clock out. Time runs out on the first half. Texas A&M comes from behind. With the score tied at 10. The pass to the fullback. They ruled fumble.
What do you think about it?
Well, I think the first half, they're an awful fine football team. I thought we played well for 26 minutes, and then we threw the interception when we're down on their 20, and then they hit the bomb when we're in man coverage, and then the halfback pass, and then the fumble on the, or the incomplete pass, whatever it is, I couldn't see it, but you just take a couple. They've had about three big plays. We give them two turnovers, and we've had one penalty. They played a flawless football game, and if we eliminate the penalties, we'll be fine, or the mistakes. We can't do it. We got to generate some mistakes from them.
Lou, a totally different-looking offense with Andrzejczyk at quarterback, throwing the ball more.
Well, it's the type of offense we like to have, but what concerns me, we don't run the ball very well. And if you don't run the football, they're controlling the line of scrimmage. The team that runs the football is the one that has a better chance, but we like to throw it.
Thank you, Coach Holtz. Good luck second half.
Thank you.
Brent, back up to you.
All right, John, thank you very much. So the question Holtz had, he said, I couldn't see it, and I think unfortunately for Notre Dame, it's pretty apparent now that the officials didn't see it, and they had that conference afterwards, and they couldn't tell whether the fullback had possession or not. I, One thing to keep in mind as far as an official is concerned, a fullback should have caught it. Didn't have possession, but they gave it a fumble to the Aggies, and they quickly marched in, scored a touchdown. Pat, we have had more offense than you and I expected.
A much bigger offensive show than I certainly expected. And I think it's been for two reasons. One, the completely different offense that Notre Dame has run with Andrew Zach at quarterback. And secondly, with A&M, with Pavlis, he's really come in and lifted that team.
The play that I'd like to go back and show again, because at the time, I didn't think there was a chance in the world that Morris could intercept this ball. The Irish are going in now. Andrzejczyk throws hard to the corner, and watch this spectacular move by number 30. He's beaten on the play. He comes over with the one hand, controls the ball. Now watch his feet. Clearly keeps them both down. He'd already hit with the right one. He did not hit that line there, folks. He'd already had the right one down. See, it was just a great athletic play. And then quickly A&M comes down and scores. Now, at 18-10, Pat, what do you do if you're Notre Dame and you score to make it 18-16?
I think you need to go for the two-point play right away and try to make it an even ball game. But with a two-point play involved earlier in the game, it changes the strategy of the game toward the fourth quarter. It'll be an interesting second half for that reason.
Now, Tim Brown started the game returning a kickoff. Texas A&M won the flip and defended a goal. They elected to go on defense right away in this game. And that backfired on them when the Irish got an early score. But now it is Texas A&M leading 18-10. Pat, you've been in bowl games. It always strikes me because of the somewhat longer half times than you get during the regular season because of the celebrations that you play two football games rather than one.
Yes, and you have a lot of time to make the adjustments at halftime. We'll have to see what Notre Dame does here offensively to try to run the football.
Now Brown at the 10. Looks for an alley in the middle. And he is out to the 33-yard line. John Burnett on the 12th man unit brings him down. Now Andrzejczyk, feeling the pressure as an option quarterback, and we asked him, how do you decide to run or pass in that situation?
But, you know, it's just what they put on you at the time, and now I'm supposed to be the Dan Marino or Joe Montana. You know, they're putting a lot of pressure on me, but, you know, I just got to do what I can do. Just do the best I can.
Here he is on first and 10, and he'll run the fullback, Anthony Johnson, with that first play.
From the second quarter on, Sammy O'Brien, the nose tackle from A&M, has taken the fullback away from Notre Dame. And that has been a key play here, and one of the reasons A&M has come back in the second quarter. And as they started here the third quarter, O'Brien stopped the fullback on the first play.
Tim Brown comes to the left side, and this time they do not slot him. They put Terrell in the slot. Brown the split in, and Andrzejczyk shows pass right away. Gets protection. Throws for Brown, and he bobbles it. It was high. He got a hand on it. Probably should have made the catch.
That's too much time to give any quarterback, and A&M dropped off in the coverage. Wallace, and I think Roper was back as well. And A&M, when they're at their best, they're bringing lots of people and lots of pressure. But this terrific pass protection here that gives Andrzejczyk a chance to get around, but then pretty good coverage that prevents the completion. And again, Tim Brown actually dropped that ball.
So it is third and long, and they put Brown back in the slot on the left side. Wallace coming, can't get through the blocker. And it's complete to Ward. He's inside the 45-yard line as Andrzejczyk to Ward for 24 yards. That has been the loneliest position on the field for Notre Dame, the other wide receiver.
And he should have a field day, really, but one of the few times we've seen Ward run an outside cut. Today, he's either been clearing out the formation for Tim Brown to come underneath him, or he's been running inside. But that time he ran the out, and he was wide open.
Alonzo Jefferson has replaced him. The Irish offensive unit continuing to keep the blitzers off Andrzejczyk, who runs the option. Cuts upfield. Adam Bob was there, so too was Batiste. The two men on the inside, Batiste and Bob, seal it up in a hurry.
I think this is a very important drive for Notre Dame. Every first series of each half is always the most critical, I think, but
Because at the end of the second half, the A&M offense was so hot, I think this is the time when you want to have a long drive and then either get 3 or 6 or 8 on the board.
Ward returns, and he brings the play in. Anderzek keeping it down the line.
Wow.
Well, I'll tell you that, Adam Bob, he's played himself a football game. Number 24 has been all over the inside.
Adam Bob in here in the middle, and the reason he's doing such a nice job of making so many plays is Sammy O'Brien and the tackles are keeping people away from Bob. He also gets a very good read on the snap count. He gets off the ball quickly, fights off Heck, the tight end's block, and is there to really put a shot on Andrzej.
One play the Irish have not shown is that pass to Green, who's a good pass catcher coming out of the backfield. Here's third and long now for their offense. He takes Green under pressure. Wallace from the backside with the blitz.
The first step of Aaron Wallace is the most critical. He is 6'4 and gets off the ball. Look, it's about a 2 or 3 yard step. He gets right around Raider, and Andrzak goes down like a British heavyweight. Unbelievable pressure from the outside by Wallace, but it's that first step of his.
Would you say a British heavyweight?
He went down like a British heavyweight.
That Henry Cooper and those guys?
those guys always went down.
A Rhodes Scholar could sail that one right over my head, huh?
All right. Phelan back in punt formation. Off the side of his foot. Gets a little bit of a Notre Dame bounce there and comes to rest at the 19-yard line. So it'll be first down when you return. Texas A&M leading Notre Dame 18-10. Just underway in the second half.
GM, meet your challenge now.
If you ask me to dish out my hard-earned money on a new car, then you better show me some real quality that's...
priced right.
GM, meet your challenge. With outstanding quality and great values, backed by the strongest warranty in GM history.
What about price?
Most popular GM cars and trucks equipped the way you want are priced lower in 1988. And right now, you can more than double your savings on option packages on some of our best-selling cars.
That's leadership.
That's GM.
Richardson, the starter, he went out for Pavlis, had difficulty throwing the ball, but Richardson back in for the Aggies' first series here of the second half. 18-10, Richardson rushing, has gained 42 yards with 7 carries. He hands off to Woodside. Woodside down at the 21-yard line. Wells comes up from the Notre Dame secondary.
Fred, you mentioned the first half. Notre Dame has a completely different defensive philosophy coming into this game, and that is a gap control defense. In the past, they've always done a read and react defense. But this time, you're going to see guys getting into gaps, and that's the kind of penetration and movement that Lou Holtz felt he needed on defense to compete with the speed of A&M.
Second and long. Pritchett and Bolta, the middle linebackers. There's the toss to Woodside coming to the short side of the field, and he is out of bounds. Short of the first down. Let's go back on that gap defense and get some more explanation.
Well, all year long, Notre Dame has been a read and react. What they do that on the read and react, the linemen would just stay right here and then go to the football. But when they run the gap defense, each guy is responsible for one gap right here like this, and they get a lot more penetration and pursuit and movement in the defense, and that's what Lou Holtz felt he needed after that Miami game when Miami beat them 24-0.
Wells is at the corner along with Spence. Streeter and Southall are the safeties. Fullback in motion. Richardson keeps it for the Texas A&M first down. So the Aggies move the chain here at the 10:50 mark of the third quarter, leading Notre Dame by 8 points.
Terrific block by Matt Wilson, the center, who is really having a very good ball game. He really has to cut off the nose tackle. And then the quarterback runs right behind him. We talked about how Richardson is a cutback runner as a quarterback, but you can only do that when your linemen push the defensive players out of the way.
Ben Amity's offense showing still another look. Right wing now is Woodside. He misjudged the snap count. Attempted to get back. They ran Gurley. Woodside doing a good job. As the Seminoles come back on Nebraska, they lead by three in the third quarter of the Fiesta Bowl. They were down early by a couple of touchdowns.
Notre Dame needs on defense is to force some sort of negative play. There have been very few negative plays that they have forced by their defense. The A&M team has really done a nice job on first down.
This is Woodside coming through the formation in motion. Richardson to throw. Gordon blitzing. He steps away from him. Now fires complete to Harris. Inside the 45-yard line. A 19-yard gain. Richardson's best pass performance of the afternoon.
Rod Harris at the bottom of the screen, number 17, does a nice job of helping the quarterback. When a receiver sees his quarterback scrambling, it's his job to get himself open and work his way back to him. You see Harris doing that, finding the soft spot, and then making the nice catch and turning it up right afterwards.
Ball to the Notre Dame 43-yard line for this first down. Woodside up the middle.
That was a nice stutter step there by Woodside. You know, a lot of backs can't make a cut on the move, but Woodside can do that. Doesn't slow down when he makes the cut. You can see him as he makes the move here. He's not losing any ground. Boom, right there. And then the big hit by Cedric Figueroa.
Now 3 yards to go. Thompson. And he runs Gurley, the fullback, wells up quickly from the secondary.
You know, Brent, you got to give Jackie Sherrill and Lynn Amedy, the offensive coordinator, a lot of credit for doing what they do best with the personnel they have. And they have Richardson in, they come out, and they run some options and some sprint out passes. Then they use the change of pace with Pavlis to throw the football.
What Bear Bryant once say about the Texas A&M coaching job? He said it's one of the toughest in the country. You need a good old tough boy to go in there and do it, and that's been the case with Jackie Sherrill. Here's third and short, full house. They power Gurley straight ahead for the first down. Inside the 30-yard line, the Aggies move the chains again here on their first possession of the second half.
Yeah, that left guard, watch Richmond Webb, the left guard right here, make a big block. And this is the backup center now, Mike Arthur, who also makes a nice block. But Webb, number 56, just buries the linebacker, Bolkar. You can't do that when you're playing inside linebacker.
The toss to Woodside. Gets outside. Spence forces him out of bounds. He's inside the 25-yard line with that run.
Well, just with that move and maybe that number, Brett, he looks a little bit like Tony Dorsett, you know? A little move, he dipped inside and then back outside. Terrific receiver.
Fabulous career down at College Station. Had a big run against the Longhorns of Texas. And that football program on the rebound this year. He beat Pittsburgh in a bowl game last night. Blue Bonnet. Ball at the 23. Now Lewis checks in. He breaks free inside the 20.
18 years old, Darren Lewis, in the stands a year ago, a tough physical runner inside. And A&M is really coming off the line. The center does a terrific job, Arthur, of controlling his man. And that's just determination there by Lewis.
So that offensive line, Wilson the center, Webb and Fontenot the guards, McCall and Lewis Cheek the tackles. Only one senior in a bunch, and that's Cheek. Now on a first down, Richardson with that option play breaks free. Richardson, the great runner, down to the 2-yard line.
Block by number 67, Jerry Fontenot. Watch him. And Richardson's going to read the block. He's pulling. Clears out the way on Bolkar. And the cutback again by the big, strong Richardson, 205 pounds. The man's a halfback, I'm convinced.
Gurley, the lone setback. Ross leads the way, the tight end, and he is stood up by Ohm.
Ohm steps into the middle of it and gets his big body right there in front of the fullback and wouldn't let him reach Pater.
In this part of the field, this is where a gap defense, where most teams you have to run the gap defense to shut off plays just like this. If you can get the back right before he gets up and gets over, like Ohm did, there is no place for him to have any room to get over the top with penetration. 13th play on this drive.
And second and goal for the Aggies. Here's Horton. He's short. That was George Streeter, the junior, filling that gap.
Brent, that was the same play that Horton ran early in the first half for the touchdown. 27 is Streeter, the strong safety. He's going to fill up as Spence, number 25, takes the outside away. Streeter comes inside. It's good coordination on the defense. The one corner takes the outside. The strong safety takes the inside away.
Third and less than a yard. Fumble. Wells wraps it up for the Irish. A huge turnover in this game, leading by 8. The Aggies cough it up, and Notre Dame will be coming out from the 20.
Terrific penetration here early by Pritchard, number 34. I think that's what made the ball come out, but as he was trying to leap up, the ball came out and Wells made the recovery in the end zone, so Notre Dame will have the ball on the 20 when we come back. He has got him, and watch Wes Pritchard. He's got the fullback and is going to get his left hand there as Gurley tries to get in the end zone. The ball pops loose after Pritchard hits him. It's right there. And then they get another break because that ball was in the end zone and didn't come out onto about the 5-yard line. And a nice timing by Pritchard. He read the ball, read the play beautifully, and got a nice jump on the snap count. That's good coordination on defense by all three inside linebackers.
Pat, Notre Dame will try Pernell Taylor in that backfield, number 46. You can see him breaking the huddle there. He'll set up in front of Green now as the fullback. He is the third Irish fullback in this game. Perhaps they want a little more blocking on these inside linebackers. Let's see. He leads the way that time. Fumble. And Emery covers it. Devastating loss for the Irish. Adam Bob with 8 tackles comes in to deliver the blow, and the ball comes free.
And there is some hitting going down there in the first day of 1988. Number 24, he takes the cutback away. Right there, Green's going to come back inside a little bit, and Bob is right there to make the stop, put his helmet on the ball, and it popped loose.
Dana Batiste recovers it at the 22-yard line, and now Pavlis checks into the game. So Adam Bob with 8 tackles and caused the fumble, and now they will go back to the passing quarterback, Pavlis. Gurley and Woodside, and on first down, Pavlis, with good protection, goes for Harris, but overthrows him and out of the end zone.
When a wide receiver doesn't give a quarterback enough room when he runs the corner route, when he runs it too close to the sideline, that's just too difficult a throw to make, and Rod Harris there just didn't give Pavlis enough room to throw the corner pattern.
Lewis checks into the game, and Woodside comes out. Oliver, the wide receiver, to the right. And the whistle blew just before the snap. This is only our 3rd penalty.
Dead ball foul, illegal procedure against the offense.
And I believe the first on A&M. Well, here's where Pavlis cannot throw the interception or take a sack. Get rid of the ball or throw the completion.
Ball is back at the 28. Second. Pavlis. Lewis on the swing. Looking for the alley. And quickly Smagala comes up from that secondary to get him down.
That's a nice little play, though. It gets him back about 6 yards. Point lead here. What you're thinking about is not turning the ball over, getting your field goal team perhaps in position to kick the field goal if you can't get the first down to make it an 11-point ball game.
They have almost 10 yards to get that first down. They must get the 13-yard line to keep this drive going. Woodside returns. He's a superb receiver. He comes out of the backfield. Pavlis, incomplete, wanted Harrison, has a penalty flag down. Corny Southall covering the wide receiver, and the penalty flag thrown.
That's a good call. Southall came over his back. Some of the Notre Dame defensive backs, Brent, are really surprised by the arm strength of Pavlis because this ball gets there quickly. I think they're reacting just a little bit slower than they would have had Richardson been there. But Southall with his left hand went over the top and went through Harris, and that was pass interference. The official made a good call.
So it will give Texas A&M a first and goal there at the 7-yard line. Now, last time, they turned it over. The Aggies leading the Irish by 8. 5:09 to go here in the third quarter.
Now, this is an area of the field where they may bring Richardson back in to run the option play inside the 10-yard line.
But right now, they're going to stick with Pavlis. See if he can close it off. Richardson could not in the previous drive. This is Woodside, cuts back. Powers his way to the 2-yard line. Now it'll be second and goal.
The tight end there, Sylvester Morgan, did a nice job of isolating the linebacker and blocking him. And that allowed Woodside to take plenty of time back there to see the entire defense. He saw the little soft spot inside and cut back inside.
The last series, they pounded at the middle. Maybe they'll try some speed wide. Let's see what Pavlis comes up with. It's Woodside. He jumped too quickly. Gets down close to the goal line. Wes Pritchett again comes up with a big hit.
Another look here as Wes Pritchett makes a stop. He's been tough inside the 10-yard line. He did jump awfully early, and he is down there. That's a good call by the official. He is down short of the goal line.
Now inches to go for the touchdown, and Richardson checks back in at quarterback. He's the runner. He keeps it. Still no indication down. There it is. Touchdown, Texas A&M. So the tradition continues at Texas A&M.
Why didn't I go to A&M?
Now the swinging gate is set. Last time they went for two out of it. Now they bring the offensive line back. And they'll turn it over to Mr. Slater. He hammers it perfect. Texas A&M 25, Notre Dame 10.
There's an awfully delayed call by the officials. There's two of them right there on either side of the quarterback to be able to see it. But as you can see, number 7, Richardson, looked like his body was over the plane of the goal line. And that's another 6 on the board for Texas A&M.
Listen to the heartbeat.
Now Chevy announces 500.
Insurance call against Southall again.
Well, we had a chance to look at it during commercial, and as you look at it now, Southall really does a nice job of actually coming over the top.
Watch
and never
the official in the back. And he's signaling incomplete. Then it's the side judge who comes in and throws the penalty flag.
On a very delayed call from way on the other side of the field, there were two officials there who did not call it. Over the top goes Southall and did not go through him with the left arm, as I said earlier.
Yeah, you know, and the way he reacted afterwards, Pat, I thought he thinks he made a great play. All right. Nevertheless, the Irish in a hole now, a penalty against Texas A&M. Now, there have been three Notre Dame turnovers that have led to 22 Texas A&M points. And as a result, they're ahead 25-10 with 3:45 to go here in the third period. Now, Pat, what can the Irish do to regain the initiative here offensively against Jackie Sherrill?
When they were hot in the first quarter, they spread the ball around. They threw the ball to Tim Brown over the middle. They hit the tight end Heck. Then they ran the fullback. Then they dumped it off the tailback Green. We haven't seen that kind of diversity here in the second half. And I think largely it's been because of the very good defense by A&M.
Oh, we got a quick moment. Tomorrow, excellent basketball game. Florida against Pittsburgh. Two premier teams. 2:30 Eastern time. That'll lead you right into CBS Sports Saturday. They'll preview those wild card games coming up. The Saints and the Vikings. Seattle will be down in Houston in the AFC. Tim Brown standing around the 14-yard line. Talbot to kick it off. Another low line drive kick. Brown's got it on one hop at the 16. Brown coming to the outside. And he is down at the 42-yard line. Ronnie Glenn of the 12th man unit tackling him for A&M. And it'll be first and 10 for the Irish after the 27-yard return by Brown.
Look at that. Unbelievable. That has really been the difference, particularly here in the second half. They have not been able to run the ball, particularly inside with the fullback. And for Notre Dame's offense, that sets up everything else.
Anthony Johnson and Mark Green are the split backs. Andrzejczyk on first down with superb protection. Keeps it and gets out of bounds. He's at the 49-yard line.
Yeah, that.
Joe Johnson, the linebacker, chasing him out. Let's go down to John Dockery quickly. John?
Hi, Brent. You may have noticed these two gentlemen along the sideline, Mr. Goga and Mr. Parker. What are you guys doing here with Jackie Sherrill?
Well, we've been with Jackie since 1977 when he first came to Pittsburgh, and we've been doing the security since then. He's invited us down to 3 Cotton Bowl. This is our 3rd Cotton Bowl with Jackie.
All the way from Allegheny County. Now up to you, Brent.
All right, with Green powering ahead up the middle inside the 45 for a Notre Dame first down. This is how the Notre Dame running attack has gone here this afternoon. Green with a little shoe problem. 4 to that left side coming outside, and the bulk of it inside. Now that is to offset the tremendous athletic talent of Roper and Wallace. Trapping the middlemen. Now Tony Brooks, the freshman, number 20, checks in at tailback. Andrzejczyk steps away from Batiste. Batiste came right up the middle to pressure him. And then Adam Bob made the stop.
I'll tell you, Brent, what A&M does is a terrific job of getting in the snap count. They are never late. They're never early. They study film, spend a great deal of time, and they can lock into the snap count. If the quarterback doesn't change his snap count up, the blitz is going to be perfectly timed.
This defense has allowed only 14.4 points a game. They've had one shutout. Andrzejczyk with Wallace coming from backside. Gets it off. Incomplete. He wanted Tim Brown. Kip Porrington. Safety man there with the coverage.
That was terrific coverage there by Corrington, too, because Brown is so tough over the middle when he's running those crossing routes. But Corrington read the play the whole way, saw that it was going to be a crossing route, and made a terrific play, almost picked off the ball. 3.98 philosophy major, Corrington is.
He's a little on the small side, but he's such an aggressive, smart football player that he'll get a look by an NFL team. Here's 3rd and long now for Andrzejczyk and the Irish. Oh, he stepped away from it that time. But it'll be 4th and long for Notre Dame. And again, Adam Bob coming inside with pressure.
For the second time, Notre Dame tried to run the screen to the left to Aaron Wallace's side, but Wallace refused to go down, and then he forced the quarterback back into Bob. But it was Wallace, number 23, who took the screen away. And the terrific quick pressure there by Price, number 88.
Notre Dame in punt formation with Phelan standing on his own 45. It's a low punt, and it'll bounce out of bounds inside the 10-yard line. A&M will have it first and 10 there at the 9. They lead Notre Dame by 15. It's 25-10, 1:42 left in the third. We're back along with John Dockery and Pat Hayden. I'm Brent Musburger. Happy New Year, everybody. Notre Dame struck first, but Texas A&M came back late in the second quarter. They have led ever since. 25-10 with 1:42 to go in the third here in Dallas. Richardson returns, and you would think now that Jackie Sherrill and Amity would go to work on the clock if they can here, relying on that offensive line that has done such a good job for the Aggies, especially the center and the two guards. Now Lewis, who's back in the game. He's cut down as he was getting outside by Mike Griffin.
Notre Dame defense really needs to force a turnover in this area of the field so that the offense can convert that into some points. Pritchard has caused some turnovers, but they've been down toward the goal line. This end of the field is where they need the turnover.
Barry Alvarez, who works with the linebackers, is taking the calls from Foz Fazio, who is upstairs in the box today. Here is Lewis, cut off, forced back inside to the heart of the defense, and that was Wells coming up. He forced him back into Tom Gorman. Great run support by the secondary that time.
And a very important third down now for this Notre Dame defense. It's 25-10. If they're going to get back into this ball game, they need to force the punt and either go after it, try to block it, or score on their next offensive possession.
Pritchett taking the defensive call. Jackie Sherrill wanting him to hurry up right now. Down toward 10 seconds to get this playoff. They're inside of 10. That's Harris. They roll, and they throw to Harris, incomplete. And Marv Spence delivering the hit for the Irish, number 25. Harris couldn't hold on, so they force a punt here. And there is a penalty flag down, however, at the 11-yard line.
Marv Spence has done a real nice job all year long covering particularly the deep pass. Last time he did a nice job of covering Harris on the outcut.
They're going to measure this one off against the Aggies. They're talking to linebacker Pritchett, and of course they'll decline it and make them punt here.
Well, the way the Notre Dame offense is playing right now, I think you have to think about trying to block a punt.
Well, it is Craig Stump, who replaced Wilson a couple of games ago. Stump will be standing near his goal line. Tim Brown is at his own 48. And they're going to give Brown a shot. One hopper trying to get to the outside, looking for the alley, and great coverage. He could get to the 48-yard line. And there is a penalty marker down. That might have been a clip as Brown was trying to get to the outside. One of the Notre Dame players might have come back on an Aggie and clipped him from behind, pushing him from behind. We'll see exactly what the call is in this situation. That was great coverage by Jackson, wasn't it, on that punt?
Well, I'll tell you what, 12th man did their job.
Got clipping on the receiving team during the run back. First down.
That was a clip, I think, that was on against Aaron Wallace, number 23, as he came down and got hit from the backside.
Yeah, that, Pat, they don't mess around with any walk-ons when they go to that punt game, do they?
Well, Aaron,
Wallace and Basil Jackson.
Right there, left of the screen, you see number 23 get hit from behind. The official was right there to make the play. And Jackson put the stop on him. You're right.
Time running out now in the third quarter. It's 25-10. And Andrzejczyk brings the Irish up. Tim Brown is out to his left. Wallace had him first. And boy, he made a lot out of that run before Alex Morris wrapped him up. Morris was the second man to hit him. And there's another penalty flag down.
Mark Green has gotten better and better as this year has gone on.
Dead ball foul, personal foul against the defense, first down.
That's a big play for the Irish.
Well, most of the breaks in the game have gone against them, we should point out. There was a questionable call in the first half and then pass interference here in the second half. And the breaks have certainly not evened out, so perhaps Notre Dame do one here in this situation. Jones, number six, gets the call against him. So the ball goes down to the Aggie, 43-yard line, with the third quarter coming to an end. 25-10, college football on CBS returns after this message and a word from your local station.
My brother thinks he's bought the perfect TV.
Sure did. It's perfect.
Everybody a healthy 1988, and we get a great view of the Cotton Bowl here in Dallas from the Goodyear Blimp America. Our pilot, Don McDuff, cameraman, Marty Hardesty. Certainly a happy new year to both of you fine gentlemen. Now, a quick summation of this game would show you what the Heisman Trophy winner has accomplished. But look at what the Aggie defense has done against the Irish running game. 49 yards, and the two inside linebackers, Bob and Batiste, 24 and 48. 10 tackles for Bob, 7 for Batiste, and a fumble recovery. Now it's first and 10 for Andrzejczyk and Notre Dame. They run Banks, and there was Batiste, number 48, looming right there in the middle. We came in here to praise Roper and Wallace, Pat, and the inside guys have done the job.
Well, that's part of the reason is because Roper and Wallace have forced things inside. Like right there, number 83, Roper came upfield, and it's tough to run outside on him. But if you're going to have such poor or little success running the ball inside with your fullback, you're going to have to throw the ball some.
And they face that here on second and 8. Andrew Beck. Diving catch to Heck, but he is short of the first down. They featured the tight end in the first half.
Yeah, well, they threw more passes, I think, in the first half to the tight end than really they threw to him in the last 7 weeks of the season. And when you get the ball to the tight end, it sets up all sorts of other things. It sets up screen passes, long passes to your wide receivers, and inside cuts by your right wide receivers, too.
Now it is third down and couple of yards maybe to go, and they'll run Brooks for the first down inside the 30. Those of you checking in on this New Year's Day, Brown, the Heisman Trophy winner, with the Irish on the board. Slater kicked a field goal. It was 7-3 Notre Dame. Went 10-3 on Grottle's 36-yarder, and then A&M quickly taking advantage of turnovers. Thompson catching a pass, and Horton blasting in a two-point conversion. Richardson, one-yard run, 25-10, and Brooks could not break free there, making the most out of that run. Adam Bob, again, bringing down a Notre Dame running back.
Down by 15, this is really the four-down zone for the Irish offense. I believe they're going to have to score a touchdown, not settle for field goals at this point in the game, and they can use all four downs to do so.
Boy, I'll tell you, one of the big decisions and important in this game was when Texas A&M went for the 2 points. That put a lot of pressure on Notre Dame trying to come back here now. Andrzejczyk rolls incomplete. Tony Brooks, the intended receiver.
By John Roper, the outside linebacker who had fallen off, did not blitz that time, fell off and covered Brooks quite well.
John Roper, only a junior, an All-American linebacker. He is number 83. No question, if he stays healthy, he is going to be one of the first players selected next year. Andrzejczyk pulling out under pressure. Lofts one toward Brown, out of bounds. And again, great pressure. That was Adam Bob who came through on Andrzejczyk.
This time they were not fooling the secondary. They ran it. Notre Dame ran this pattern earlier where Ward went downfield and then Brown came underneath him. This time two defenders right there, actually three, as Corrington comes over on top. And there's no way to be fooled there. Three defenders around Brown, and it looks like they will go for it now on fourth down.
The ball is at the Aggie 28. They must get inside the 20 for a first down. Andrzak takes off. Short of the first down with Batiste coming in from the rear and Kip Corrington coming up to seal from the secondary. Another great defensive performance here by these Aggies.
And that was excellent coverage back in the defensive backfield by A&M. And the outside pressure forces Andrzak to step up into the pocket. That's Roper and Wallace. They force him inside, and the combination with a good pass coverage, and there's nowhere to go.
The last two sets of linebackers to leave Texas A&M both went to the National Football League. This quartet appears to be no different. Now Pavlis hands off to Gurley, and he blasts his way out to the 32-yard line. Downstairs to John Dockery with a legend. Doc?
Brent, it was 30 years ago that Texas A&M had its only Heisman Trophy winner, John David Crow. What about today's game? Name of the game for Texas A&M?
Defense. Defense, defense, defense. And our offense is, you know, hey, I tell you what, when you watched our team all year, our offense has played real well today. I'm just as proud as that. Boy, I'm telling you what, it's great to be an Aggie today. Great to be an Aggie.
You are, of course, the assistant athletic director. What about Tim Brown and the Heisman? Was he your choice?
Oh, yes. I think that he represents what the Heisman means and what our old guys think that it should mean. Is he's got an awful lot of class, and he's a great athlete, and he certainly is a credit to college football.
Well, you are also, you provided us many a thrilling moment.
Thank you very much. Okay. It's just great to be here.
Thank you. Brent, Pat?
Yeah, Doc, we'll second that. John David Crow, isn't he a great, tough football player? Now it's Woodside coming out to the 35.
And Lance Pavlis back in. There's a penalty flag on the play as well.
Going against the Aggies here. 12 minutes to go in the game. And we'll start our wild card coverage on CBS. Time. The Vikes and the Saints meeting in New Orleans. Coach Jim Mora and general manager Jim Finks had an opportunity to ask Jim Finks in situation when he arrived in Chicago, and he said, be perfectly honest, there were a lot more good football players already in New Orleans when we got here.
And as you well know, New Orleans is one of the most difficult places for an opposing team to play in the NFL.
25-10, A&M leading Notre Dame. Pavlis throws to the tight end, Morgan. Wow.
What a catch by Morgan.
16-yard gain, his first catch of the game, getting up there with one of those big paws. Last year, they featured the tight end.
Rod Bernstein was the number one draft pick. This year, they have not. The tight end's only caught seven. That's Morgan's eighth catch of the year. But he's a very good block. When they run outside on the sweep, Morgan is usually leading the play.
Now, that was first and 20 after the holding call, so this leaves A&M with second and four. Here's the toss to Woodside. First down and out of bounds at the 48-yard line.
And that's what just the play we were talking about. When they won the sweep to the outside, you need the block at the tight end and the fullback to run the sweep play into the boundary, and that's what A&M got there.
Jerry Fontenot leading the way with another great block. That entire offensive line, Wilson, Webb, Fontenot, McCall, Cheek.
Notre Dame's defense needs to create a turnover here, Brett. They need some penetration on defense.
Woodside is on the wing, and they run Gurley, the fullback, to the middle of the field for a couple of yards on first down. Check that possession chart. A couple of touchdowns. Then they fumbled going in. Then they scored again and finally punted. And now in control of the clock as it comes down inside of 10:50 with a 15-point lead on Notre Dame.
Very consistent offensive performance by A&M, moving it on four of those five possessions.
And I think you're looking at a football team that will challenge for a national title. They're going to run, fake the end around. Lewis keeps it. One man, and he's caught from behind. or Lewis would have gone to the end zone. As it was, he gained 29 yards. What a great fake of an end around.
Ordinarily, you set this play up by running the end around, but A&M had not done that yet today. Tony Thompson, number 80, is going to get the fake on the reverse as Lewis fakes the ball to him, and all the defenders went with Thompson. And then actually Frank Stams, number 30, does a nice job of bringing down Lewis. Otherwise, he would have scored.
So now the first down, and here is Gurley, the fullback. And he bolts free to the 10-yard line.
Offensive line is completely taking control of this football game. The defense of Notre Dame has been on the field for too long. And you talk with coaches and you ask why you're concerned about your defense being on the field for so long. It's because it takes twice as much energy to play defense. But look at the size of the hole here for the running back, Gurley. He might have even squeezed out a couple of, maybe a 2-yard gain out of that.
Woodside, the tailback for the Aggies. He's got it on the toss behind Gurley, and Griffin from behind brings him down inside the 10-yard line.
The game plan for A&M was to rush the ball outside today, but they've really had success running the ball inside, and I think they were surprised with some of the success they've had inside, but they've kept after it. They've had some success, and they've run the ball inside.
Now it is second down with the ball at the Notre Dame 9-yard line. Woodside steps in motion. Pavlis with great protection this time. Couldn't get an open receiver. And he stepped out of bounds inside the 10-yard line. Good coverage in that secondary by the Irish that time.
This is an important game, I think, for Lance Pavlis. He was a guy who was under some duress, was benched earlier in the year, as you watch Pavlis dance around here. But he's only a redshirt freshman. He's got 3 years left. Jackie Sherrill still expecting big things out of the thrower, Pavlis. Good coverage downfield here by Marv Spence, number 25, who's really had a great year at corner for the Fighting Irish.
A&M rushing for 237 yards in this Cotton Bowl, and Notre Dame for only 63. Pavlis. Incomplete. And it would be field goal time for Jackie Sherrill and the Aggies. This would put them up by 18. And they would force Notre Dame to score three times in the last 8:37.
And Brent, A&M has only given up, I think, 21 points the entire fourth quarter this season.
Been one of the more dominating defenses in football. 25-yard attempt here by Slater. Stumped the holder. And the scoreboard moves again for the Aggies. So now, Texas A&M closing in on its second Cotton Bowl triumph in 3 years. We'll be right back.
The NFC playoff battles begin Sunday on CBS Sports.
Round of lights here.
Hey, Tom, did I get a watch that, huh? That's yours, it's you. Oh, wow. Oh, I have put the corner in this thing. Oh, wow.
Five career field goals, and that's a record. Now it's the 12th man, and boy, do they want a piece of the Heisman Trophy winner, Tim Brown.
Just playing for A&M, something I dreamed about my whole life. And now, just in my last game of the season, having an opportunity, and all the other guys I know that to had just hit, get a lick on the Heisman Trophy winner is just something that would just cap off the season for all of us.
John Burnett, he's one of them out there ready to come down the field, number six. Number nine's been a killer. These are walk-on football players. Here comes Brown against him again. He's got an alley in the middle, but he cannot get outside. And that was William Thomas. Folks, that's a ringer. Jackie Sherrill brought in a ringer, and now there's a fight down. And it breaks out in the middle of the field. Thomas was right in the middle of it. Both Tim Brown and Thomas following that kickoff return. Let me tell you that there's nothing walk-on about William Thomas. He's a backup safety man. He's a freshman. Now, watch Timmy Brown come up and return this kickoff. Now he's down. And remember, he's playing with that back problem. And Brown sets sail after number 11. He brings him down from behind, and that causes the benches to empty. Tim Brown went back after him. Now, here's the young man you just heard from, Burnett. He got picked off. And number 11, Thomas, brings him down.
I don't know what Tim Brown was so upset about, Brent, really, on the replay. It didn't really look like he got kneed in the back to me there. He got hit.
I think Jackie's saying the same thing. You've got to throw him out of the game in this situation. He ran after my man, jumped him from behind. There's Slocum, the defensive coordinator. He adds a few words from that sideline. I find myself in agreement with Coach Sherrill.
The offense.
No reason for Tim Brown to go after a player like that.
Oh, I realize that a star needs to be protected and everything in a football game, but he's like everybody else out there. He can't completely lose his cool, and we didn't see anything that was unnecessarily dirty. However, you know, maybe something went down in the pile. Let's take another look here at this tackle.
That's William Thomas, number 11, Brent. Who made the tackle, unless he said something after the play, which he may have done, but he certainly didn't take a cheap shot at him.
He might have said something, Pat. You're absolutely right. Might have said something.
Still no reason to do that.
Now, Tony Rice checks in as quarterback for Notre Dame. To start this series, it's Rice. He keeps it on the option. His fullback was crushed. His fullback is down. Sammy O'Brien blasted in, and Johnson shaken up off the fake.
A&M defenders get off the line of scrimmage so fast. It's Batiste, number 48. See, again, he reads the snap count beautifully, and he's there. As soon as the guard steps away, he's up in the hole. And those guys don't slow down, those inside linebackers of the Aggies.
Now Brown still in the game. He is out to the left. Second down, and Rice's first pass intercepted, and it was Corrington at the 30-yard line. This will be a fired-up Aggie bunch the rest of the way.
You can talk about how smart Kip Corrington is all you want, but he's also a very fine football player, a great tackler. Great anticipation on the reads from the free safety position.
Now Richardson comes back in at quarterback for Sherrill. The ball is at the Notre Dame 30-yard line. It's first and 10. 7:53 to go. It's 28-10. Aggies in control and threatening again. This will be Gurley straight ahead into the heart of that defense. Close to the 25-yard line.
Florida State comes back on Nebraska. For the last 2 years, I think A&M has gotten to the Cotton Bowl with an offense, a finesse offense, where they've thrown the ball all around the field. This year, the characteristic of this A&M team is its defense. They have been dominating all season long. And that's the defensive coordinator, R.C. Slocum, in the gray sweatshirt right there, who's done a marvelous job.
His philosophy is to put as much pressure on the quarterback as you possibly can.
Now second down for the Aggies. Richardson. First down to the 15-yard line. I'll tell you something. That incident where Tim Brown came over and tackled Thomas, that has these Aggies on fire. They want another touchdown now, and in the worst way.
Richardson is such a strong inside runner for a quarterback. I'm really amazed. He was a high school wishbone quarterback. Really has not thrown the ball. He is not a redshirt. He will be a polished thrower by the time he leaves A&M, but he's a very good runner right now as an 18-year-old freshman.
He's carried 11 times for 74 yards here in this 52nd Cotton Bowl. Now here's the toss, and it's Woodside. He's inside the 10-yard line. Spence tackles in for Notre Dame.
The only time you can have that kind of success running outside, and when you see no penetration, you know your tight end is doing a job. Brian Ross, number 86, really took on the linebacker and allowed Woodside to pick up 6 yards.
Anders Ek watching from the Irish sideline.
Come on, D, let's go, D!
Richardson getting the call. Lewis checks in, and Woodside is out. So Lewis comes to the left wing. Early pound straight ahead. He is short of the first down, and Mike Griffin again wraps him up. He's been active there in the middle of that defensive line for Notre Dame. The helmet would indicate that there has been some hammering going on here in this Cotton Bowl.
That warning on the helmet is well deserved today, believe me. Look out.
Now this is third down and a couple of yards for the first down for Texas A&M. 5:25, 28-10, Aggies leading. Oliver, the motion man. Richardson keeps it. Touchdown, Texas A&M. Offensive show for the Aggies. They swing the gate over now. And Slater is due to hammer one across. He's a fine kicker. Only a junior. Pulled that one a little bit, didn't he? But still good.
Brent, Notre Dame has overrun Bucky Richardson on the option play all day long. All day long, he's cut inside. Watch all the white jerseys run outside, and then he just cuts it right back inside and breaks another tackle to get in the end zone.
The scenario with these guys, Drew, with the mergers and acquisitions area.
One thing that we were concerned about. This number 11 is Warren Barhorst. He's the one who got involved with Tim Brown. He's the 12th man. The other number 11, William Thomas, is over on the sideline. He is not and has not been going downfield on the kickoff. It was a pure 12th man unit that went downfield and got into the incident. Now, right here watching is the young man we said was out there, and he was not. All right, Thomas was not out there. It is Barhorst. But Tim Brown will not be returning this kickoff for Notre Dame. Waters is the deep man. And instead, it'll be the fullback, Banks, who's got it at the 24. He's got an alley. And they punish him around the 44-yard line. So let me again remind everybody about the Saturday program. College basketball coming your way at 2:30, Florida against Pittsburgh. After that is CBS Sports Saturday. Get a roundtable discussion. We'll include some handicapping, I'm sure, with the Saints and the Kings and the Seahawks and the Oilers. So again, the 12th man, that unit, they have their own numbers, and there are some duplicates out there, and that's how we got confused, and I certainly don't want to misidentify the young man who got into it with Tim Brown. Rice now his second series for the Irish, goes incomplete for Heck.
Brent, I'm a little surprised that Kent Graham is not in the game for Notre Dame at quarterback. He has been their throwing quarterback all season long, the guy that's really played their third-team quarterback coming into today's game. And he is known as their thrower, a big guy, 6'5", 225.
Well, here's the story of this game. Four turnovers, and again, one of the most costly back there in the first half was that fumble on that swing pass to Banks. Controversial call going against the Irish. Here in the second half, the Aggies have done a job like that defensively. Roper and Terry Price in on that tackle. Roper 83 and Price is 88. And a day that started out with a great kickoff return and then a touchdown catch for Tim Brown wound up with an ugly incident here in the Cotton Bowl. And again, like Miami, the Aggies have been able to shut down this Irish attack. Rice pulls straight back. Throws complete and it's dropped there. That was Alonzo Jefferson. Let's go downstairs to John Dockery. Doc?
Hey, Brent, while we have a moment, it's interesting to look how things have changed over the 50-plus years of the Cotton Bowl. In 1937, a train ride from Houston to Dallas, only $7. Now $123. A game ticket, $340. Now $25. And in 37, the winner took home $10,000. Now both teams take home $2.2 million. My, have things changed. Back to you, Brent.
You got that right, Doc.
4:10 left here. Texas A&M wrapping up this Cotton Bowl over Notre Dame. Phelan with the punt. And Harris steps out of bounds there at the 20-yard line. So it'll be Notre Dame's ball after that 41-yard punt. They trail Texas A&M 35-10.
Who says Chevy's better than Ford? USAC tested standard half tons with their best automatics.
As Coach Slocum with his defensive unit, young man who has, he worked with John Robinson for a while.
Southern Cal, been an assistant though at A&M on and off for 15 years, really has done a nice job the last few years with the Aggies.
Now Richardson and the Aggie offense will go to work against that clock and Gurley. Comes out to the 24-yard line on first down.
Well, for A&M, it was an unexpected year, I think, Brent. A year from now, this is going to be a terrific A&M team, I think. And for Notre Dame, considering their liabilities they had on defense and some question marks at quarterback, they had an awfully good year to get here to Cotton Bowl.
How about this team next year? Jackie Sherrill figures to be, I guess, in the top five with this win. They'll vault into the top 10 for the season, you would think. Coaches had them ranked 13th, and the AP, they were also 13th. Now they run the toss play. That's Larry Horton, the ball carrier. Oh, we get word that Florida State, behind McManus, beats Nebraska 31-28. I hate to ask you again, Mr. Hayden, but
I knew it was coming.
I don't want to start 88 the way
we Yeah. You always go for the win, I still say.
Well, congratulations to the Aggies of Texas A&M, though. This has not been a one-year adventure. They were not favored to win the Southwest this year. That should have been Arkansas. They shut out Arkansas. I believe it was 14-0. Now Waddle going in motion. They showed us a little bit of everything today. And this Richardson, one of the better-looking running quarterbacks, you'll see. He comes out to the 39-yard line before Southall tackles him.
And, Brent, the difference has been speed. A&M has all the speed on the field, but a year from now, Lou Holtz believes, he's going to put 11 players on defense on the field who will run 4, 8, and better, and that is going to make a big difference for the Irish on defense.
Pavlis checks in at quarterback. 2:19 to go. Richardson comes off to the sideline behind Coach Sherrill. Oh,
There are freshman quarterbacks here for the Aggies. As flags and the whistle sounded prior to the snap.
I'm trying to think that Craig Stump, the senior quarterback, would get a chance, too, to play a little bit in his last Cotton Bowl.
Well, I'll tell you, that offensive line, they didn't receive a whole lot of credit
dead
this year
foul.
For the Aggies.
False start, offense.
But you remember that Jackie Sherrill lost two players who signed illegally with an agent. One of them was Brantley, a tackle, and McCall, 6'8", 300 pounds, stepped into that tackle spot and did a job. Over the other tackle, it was Cheek, 6'6", 280. And then in the middle, Wilson, 6'5", 275. Webb, 6'7", 260. Motneau, 6'4", 250. Only one senior in the bunch, and that's Lewis Cheek. A&M with 284 yards rushing. Behind that group, and getting more with Horton, the ball carrier.
Horton is another freshman they're very, very high on. They had three of the most sought-after running backs that came to A&M last year in high school, Horton being one of those.
We've got an opportunity, and I want to thank our stats crew for the great job all year. Not only Roger Riley up here in the box, but Lance Garrett, who works downstairs in one of our Chiron trucks. And we had a special spotter for A&M, Rick Hall. He handled the offense and the defense. The 12th man unit, well, Jimmy Tubbs was in charge of that today. Luke Cody, and he did the stage managing for us. And young man from New Hampshire by the name of Scott Musburger, he did pretty good spotting, too, in his first game today.
He did all right, didn't he?
And there goes Tim Brown. The next time you'll see him, probably be in the Senior Bowl or as the scouts check him out. They clear him off the field. And Texas A&M now bringing the clock down. 45 seconds to go, and it's too bad that a great career and a Heisman Trophy and what I thought was an outstanding performance here had to be marred by that incident where Tim Brown chased back out after the 12th man. Something probably was said down there on the field, and you know, when you think back to it, Tim Brown was a little upset about Benny Blades talking to him, and I guess when you're a target, Tim, you got to be ready for stuff like that. You had a great career, and it's too bad it wound up this way. 45 seconds to go. Well, when we started the day, Tim Brown said he wanted to explode. He did in several ways here this afternoon. And a disappointing Cotton Bowl for Lou Holtz, too. He has been in every major bowl until the Cotton Bowl. Now he's been in his first, and I dare say he'd like a rematch. We'll be right back.
You want anything?
How about a light? Alabama Crimson Tide is the Aggies' first Cotton Bowl win in 27 years. And when the game was over, the Bear came inside the Aggies' locker room.
I excused myself from all the media, and I walked over to Coach Brown, and I said, Coach, did you want to see me? And he said, no. I've seen enough of you. He said, I want to congratulate your players.
Another one of the Bears boys, Jackie Sherrill, closing in here on a Cotton Bowl victory, his second in 3 years. Mike Stallings, Sherrill, a tough guy. Keeping that sideline patrol even with 30 seconds left here in this Cotton Bowl.
Yeah, 25-point lead.
And Stump, the senior quarterback, getting off what figures to be his last punt. You are looking at a Texas A&M team, don't you think, Pat Hayden? It'll be back near the top next year.
Oh, absolutely. It's a young team. We saw three true freshmen really contribute today.
Now we want to thank Michael Burks and Joe Assetti for the job they have done covering college football. Ed Gorin with the halftimes, along with Jimmy Nance and Ara Parsegan, and all the rest of the members of this crew who've done such an excellent job, not just today, but all season long. We wish all of you a happy new year, and to the families that they had to leave to be here in Dallas today, too. With Kent Graham bringing the clock down for Notre Dame, he'll take a sack, and Roper, number 83, closes in, and now he'll take the penalty.
Yeah. Roper was talking a little too much, and the official was right there and called an unsportsmanlike conduct penalty on him.
we want to find out some more about the Tim Brown story. Let's go down to John Dockery. Doc?
Brent, here's what I've been able to find out. Tim Brown right now is in the locker room. He left the field. What one of the 12 men tried to do was to rip the towel away from Tim Brown, his towel that he was carrying in his waist. Well, Brown didn't like that, and that's what started the whole ruckus. Right now, Tim Brown out of the game, as I said. Back to you, Brent.
All right, John. Thank you. 15 seconds left, and Texas A&M will beat Notre Dame in the first game that these two fine schools have ever played against each other in football. That's hard to believe. Two schools with such rich traditions as Notre Dame and Texas A&M. Yet here it is, the beginning of 1988, they meet for the first time. And the men in red have done the hammering. They'll count it down in Aggie Land now. You know, when I came down here for the Cotton Bowl 3 years ago, all I heard was Aggie jokes. Folks, I think the joke's on us. This is a pretty good football team. Midway through the season, he carried a quarterback off. And the Aggies begin the celebration, beating Notre Dame 35-10. Probably a smart thing, clearing Tim Brown off the field to avoid any kind of an incident after the game.
Well, Brent, the Aggie defense was every bit that I had heard that it was. They were sensational.
All right, let's go downstairs to John Dockery. Doc?
Thank you, Brent. Jackie, we knew you had a good defense, but we didn't think you had this much of a ground game.
Well, we've been able to run the ball all year, and that's not a point. I felt like offensively we could match up front, and we talked about their people, certainly defensively. I did not think they could run the ball on us, but I was giving them a lot of credit before the game. I think that when you look at our offensive line and you look at our running backs and you throw in the option game, then our players are ready to play.
They certainly were. Let me just ask you one question. What happened on the Tim Brown play? It was along the sideline with you.
Well, what happened on the kickoff when he got tackled and Tim Brown started running down the field and he hit the guy in the back and knocked him down.
And that's how you saw it. Okay,
that's
Coach.
How it happened.
Congratulations.
Thank
okay,
you.
Now back to you, Brent.
All right, John. Thank you very much. So the 52nd Cotton Bowl is now history. Texas A&M beats Notre Dame 35-10 here in Dallas, Texas.
Performance. For some, it's more than a passion. It's a